All right, the College of Complexes, and tonight we have Joe Balkis with us. Joe is a Teamster, and Brother Joe will be telling us, giving us an update on the organized labor movement as a whole, and a report on the Teamster contract at UPS. Any further ado, we have with us Joe Balkis.
In September of 2012, the Chicago Teachers Union went on strike. You know, they went on strike and they won. It was a defensive victory, but it was a victory. But it didn't happen by accident. They had to organize. They had to have the kind of leadership that mobilized the membership. And this came about, you know, it just didn't come about by accident. They had to do a lot of hard work, and they created an organization called CORE, which had supporters inside and outside the teachers' union. And then what they did is they won, the rank and file movement won the election for the teachers' union, okay? And they spent time and effort, okay, mobilizing the teachers, getting the teachers active and involved in the union, getting the parents involved, and getting the students involved. And what they did is also worked with a bunch of different community organizations. They did a lot of different groundwork, you know, get elected, and they did a lot of work building solidarity among the students, the teachers, and the parents, because what you want to do in a contract campaign is reach out to your customers. I mean, this was done at the UPS strike as we built solidarity while the contract campaign, when we went on strike in 97, one of the things we did is the face of UPS to the public and the customers is the drivers. So most of the drivers have good relationship with their customers, their businesses, and everything like that. So what they did is when the strike came near, they let the customers know they might want to start looking for other shipping companies, gave them a heads up, and then gave them these signs saying, not that sign, but they gave them another sign not accepting UPS packages. So they built that solidarity among the customers. And that's what the teachers union did, built that solidarity with the customers, their customers being the students and the parents. Okay. Another thing, you know, to build the solidarity, one of the things they did before and after the strike was forums. They would have these community forums, you know, and they were active and involved in that to build the solidarity among, you know, the students, the teachers, and the parents. And also, the CPS was also Chicago Public School System, the bad guys, you know, the administration, you know, Rahm Emanuel, you know, and all that. Well, what they did is, you know, they tried to create grassroots groups, you know, well, AstroTurf groups is what they call the phony grassroots groups, you know, and they only had small numbers and stuff like that. And also they had these fabricated forums that they would actually listen to the, you know, parents and the students, but their mind was already made up. But we made sure at these events that they were, you know, full with organized teachers, not just from that school, because they would have a forum for a particular school, but the teachers would, other teachers from other schools would come in solidarity, you know, parents, different groups. There was one group called COCO, but there's, and every, you know, in different communities, there was different community organizations against the school closing. I mean, even prior to this attack in Chicago, you know, the widespread attack on the schools, there was this school, I think it was called Whittier School, that they were trying to close the library. And, you know, they had this little building, this field house, and they wanted to knock it down. And what happened was, is the community wanted to create a library out of it. So they did, you know, necessary tactics. They did the community organizing around it. You know, and the CPS was trying to say it was all torn down, it cost more money to fix. They were lying, you know, they got their own people to look at it. And what they actually did, they stopped it by occupying the building. You know, they occupied the building and said, we want to create the library. So people, you know, see, when there's these things, where these actions, where people are taking action, I think people are apathetic, you know, a lot of times, because they don't feel what they can do can make a difference. They don't know what to do. But once something happens and it gets out there, people want to be active and involved. I, you know, I went down there, different organizations went down there, different People went down there. I spent a couple nights there on occasion. I went to my attic, got books for them, you know, to donate, you know, and they got it up and running, and they stopped, you know, they stopped them from closing it, you know. And so then, all these different actions, that would be like one action, all these different forms, you know, all these different organizations, they're building solidarity along the way. So then, as the time was going on, and they're negotiating, and, you know, the teachers' union, CTU, they negotiated in good faith. You know, they held off going on strike, you know, to stay back, you know, going back to the table with the CPS, you know, in good faith, but, you know, the Rahm Emanuel and the CPS was putting out information that they're all close, they're lying all the way, saying how everything is going good. And they went back in good faith, and basically they didn't give them a serious offer, so then they went out on strike. But before they did, they had just practicing pickets. See, so they were going out picketing the schools with signs saying just practicing. So this sends a message to them that they're serious. You know, all the teachers out there just practicing. So this sends a message to the Chicago public school system that they were serious. This sends a message to Rahm Emanuel, you know. But it also does something else. You need escalating action. You know, some people aren't ready, you know, to go on strike, or they aren't ready to, you know, to risk being arrested, doing nonviolent civil disobedience occupations. So what you do is you might start them out by wearing a t-shirt or a sticker day, and then, you know, and then they did it, and they feel empowered that they did it with other people and other workers and stuff like that. And then it's just practicing. They had just practicing pickets. So they did all that. So then they feel they could do that, and they feel empowered. So this is preparing the ever-escalating tactics. So, but it was the, you know, it was, you need the kind of leadership that can mobilize the membership. And it's only going to come from a rank-and-file type of leadership. Because the people in power, you know, whether it's union officials or companies or, you know, bureaucrats, union government bureaucrats, whatever, you know, they like the way things are going, you know. Yeah. It's the workers that are actually working under these terrible conditions, you know, that, you know, with little pay and bad working conditions. They're the people that want change. So we need somebody by the, you know, from the people, of the people, and for the people to make a difference. Change doesn't ever, you know, come from the top. Right. You know, so another thing is they did is they had press conferences. So besides winning your particular customers, you want the general public on your side too, in different particular situations. But like, for example, in the public sector, you know, and when it's government, people who are elected to office, you want the public opinion, because this could force government, you know, elected government officials to do the right thing on some occasions, you know, if they feel they won't, you know, get reelected because of this, you know. So they're having these press conferences, and the Chicago teachers won the hearts and minds of the public. They were seen in a more favorable light than Rahm Emanuel and everything like that. So that's another important battle. And that's that brings me back to UPS. I mean, because I'm a Teamster, I work at UPS. In 97, we won the hearts and minds of the general public when we went on strike in 97. Ron Kerry, the kind of leadership that mobilized the membership. I'll talk more about how he's by the people and for the people. But he had a message that part-time America won't work. UPS didn't know what hit them. They said if they knew we were going to go with that, they would have came up with a whole different strategy. But the message was part-time America won't work. We're fighting for full-time jobs for all America. So that won the hearts and minds of the general public, you know, because people were getting paid $8 an hour in 1997, and that was considered terrible. I think it was terrible back then, but thing is, it's at $8.50 right now, so it's even more terrible now, because $8.50 doesn't go half as far as $8 went in 97. But we'll get back to that when I get more particular on the UPS. But so the press conferences, we got the message out to the public. Every time that Rahm Emanuel went out and did his press conference, I mean, we'd have our press conferences, and there would be rebuttals, and there would be back and forth, but we won the hearts and minds on the press conferences every time. We got the message out to the public. And another example, look, we had the forms, right? Another thing we had is these t-shirts. You see these t-shirts here? You know, standing with the Chicago teachers? We had the t-shirt We had the t-shirts here, so these are for the supporters of the teachers union. So then we're at these different rallies, pickets. They see the people wearing these shirts that were organized. Okay, and also we had not just the forums in the community, we also did outreach to bring more support to the Chicago teachers. Okay, we had forums all across the Midwest. I went out to Milwaukee. I go to so many places I can't remember. I think this one was Milwaukee, not Madison, because I was out to Madison for something else. I think it was Milwaukee at a union hall. But we were having forums at different union halls, and I think this one was the UAW. And what we would do is have a speaker from the Chicago Teachers Union talk about the Chicago teachers strike or the impending strike, before and after, and what was going on. And then we would have t-shirts to sell that also to raise funds for the Chicago Teachers Union. So, we raised funds for them also, for their strike fund. And we also got the message out, right? So then we got support and solidarity from unions all across the Midwest, all across the country. So, and I was part of an organization. Through Occupy Labor, we had a Chicago Teacher Solidarity Campaign. So it was a lot of people, from the general labor movement in Chicago that wanted to pitch in and help out, with the Chicago teacher struggle, because they're our struggle. Their struggle is our struggle, they're attacking them, they're attacking us, it's one idea of the IWW concept, one big union, everything like that. So we did all that. So when the strike, went and happened, we also did outreach to other unions, not just the members, but union officials, administrations. We asked for financial support, for the teachers union to contribute to strike fund. So I did that in my local. I went to the e-board, to talk to them about supporting the teacher strike and everything like that for a few $100 or whatever. So then the head of our local started talking to Karen Lewis and everything. And, I got the ball rolling. I didn't say I brokered this deal or anything, but they started talking. And what they did for the Chicago Teachers Union is allowed the teachers to use our 705 auditorium union hall for the strike headquarters, as well as offices and phones and equipment, far more than a few hundred dollars than, we're asking that they donate for use, for the Chicago Teachers Union, a central location to be the strike headquarters. So what did I do over there? Well, I was over there directing traffic at the union hall, showing the teachers where to park during the strike, providing the strike support. As a member of Chicago Teacher Solidarity Campaign, we provided strike support for the teachers union. So what we would do is man the picket lines. When they needed more people at a certain picket line, we'd bring people out. We'd drive people around. We'd man the strike headquarters. We did a lot of support work in addition to having the forums. But when I was parking the cars, I met people from all around the country. I mean, there were people from Minnesota that came out here, that were teachers, that they, heard about the Chicago Teachers Union strike. And they happened to know my fellow people out in Minnesota that were TDU, because they were active in the labor movement. So they knew Teamsters out there I knew. So when they said they were from Minnesota, I was like, hey, this person. And they're like, yeah, I know them. Because if they came out this way, they're in with the, active in the labor movement there. So, I mean, that was like Chicago Teachers Union. It was basically a defensive victory. They fought back and won. They beat Rahm Emanuel in every battle. But it's going to be seen if they're going to win the war, because right now, they won the contract, but they didn't win, all the necessary job protections that they could. That they actually need to win, because they're still in this process of, closing the schools. Right, just recently they fired like 850 people that work at the schools. A mix of this is just Friday, teachers, and staff and everything like that. Now, but as we did the strike, then the battle continued. Okay, they were fighting, they were fighting against the closing of the schools. Okay, and just recently, not too long back, we had a 3-day march against the school closings. And because of that march, they closed 3-4 less schools than they were going to close, but they're still closing the 50 schools. So the more struggle that we can, you know, put out there, the more struggle we can put, the, you know, the more we can win. Like, another thing I didn't mention, like, during this whole time, there were so many marches and rallies against the, you know, for the Chicago teacher strike, against the school closing. They were, you know, they were surprised by the sea of, you know, red shirts. And then I saw Tom Morello, they had new musicians come down. And I'm pretty sure that was one of the teachers' rallies. I've gone to so many, it's hard to keep track which is which. But they had so many big rallies. The bigger the rallies, the more the people turn out, the more support we get, the more victories we can win. So, I mean, when you fight back, you win. And the more you fight back, the more you win. I mean, these are the lessons to be learned. And there's, like, the contradiction that the Teamsters local, my local supporters, Chicago Teachers Union. But we need to do that, the mobilization, you know, that we did in 97. We need to do the mobilization that the Teachers Union just did. I mean, we had that lesson just right in front of us just last year, and they continue to struggle. And that's the kind of struggles that we need to have to get our victories. Because anything you want, anything you get in this world is through struggle. It's not just going to be, you know, handed to you. You know, and this was like the big struggle in Chicago over the past year, and the struggle continues. But it's been nothing but attacks on the public sector unions, okay? I mean, this is the t-shirt from the Chicago Teachers Solidarity Campaign you see right here. Well, you see how important, you know, t-shirts are in campaigns. Another thing that's important in campaigns is signs. What we got here? We got all these signs over here for the Chicago Teachers Union. So they're like all over, you know, the city of Chicago, you know, they try to get signs in people's yards, in their windows, so then, especially anywhere near a school, you know, where they can see it. So then, you know, it's out there and they can see the community support. This is one way to show community support. Now this, the t-shirts are, you'll see these more by the activists at the particular marches. But, you know, winning the messaging and having it out there, and this is just, you know, different things that should be done during a contract campaign.
Oh, yeah. Excuse me, miss.
Yeah, that's what I have. Yeah, the music. No ice. But anyway, now there was the postal workers were fighting against cuts, too. You got this knuckleheaded postmaster general, okay, and certain politicians. If I'm not mistaken, it was this guy, David Issa, and he actually owns UPS stores. That's why he wants to attack the snow postal workers union and cut them. There. Now, it's gonna be a little confusing over here because there's all these contradictions with the post office and UPS. You know, but I'm for workers whether they work at the post office or at UPS. You know, in solidarity. It's, you know, it's UPS, you know, trying to, you know, squeeze us, and it's the postmaster general, you know, and the politicians, you know, at the post office trying to squeeze them for their own best interest. What they want to do is an austerity program to cut public services. And anytime they cut public service, anytime they try to privatize public services, what happens is the cost goes up because they got to pay CEOs. Because, I mean, they got, you know, the CEO of UPS making $10 million. I don't think the Postmaster General makes that much. And you got to pay all these stockholders money. And you're not doing it to provide a service anymore. You know, you're doing it to make money. So, you know, it's that profit motive, and it's profit makes the cost goes up, you know, and they're more concerned about making money than providing a service. So the postal worker, they had their attack, and what they wanted to do, what they were doing was closing post offices, and they wanted in 6-day delivery. So, you know, you saw the same kind of tactics. So they wanted to go to the 5-day deliveries, and you saw some of the same people, because same people that were involved in the struggle for the teachers were involved in the struggle for the post office. It's the same, you know, the same likely suspects, you know, like me and everybody else in the Chicago Labor Solidarity. Well, you know, just, you know, now it's the Chicago Labor Solidarity Campaign, so we're helping the general labor movement. But they did the same things. They had the marches, the rallies. They marched down over, you know, by Obama's house. We marched over, you know, different post offices. We had rallies at the Federal Plaza. You know, we had these rallies and marches And also, there was also nonviolent civil disobedience being done in the Chicago Teachers Union struggle that they just recently, in a three-day march, I digressed, but they actually occupied City Hall and there were people arrested. I mean, so these are the different tactics you got to use. The more you do, the more you're going to get. So the one thing that's important in these campaigns is t-shirts. You know, you see the members wearing it, you see the activists wearing it, it sends the message that there's support. You know, you got the sign.
Yes, honey.
You know, here's another sign against the ending the six-day, you know, they want to end the six-day delivery. Because this would affect, you know, the poor people, you know, more disproportionately, you know, that, you know, don't have internet access or whatever. And they're talking about, they can do a lot of creative ideas, you know, to keep, you know, keep more business in the post office. They can have, you know, they can have internet turnstile, you know, stations inside there. They can, you know, have fax. And there's a lot of different things they can do, bring more service in. But the attack on the postal workers, almost forgot the big thing about it. They have to fund their health care, if I'm not mistaken, for health care or pension for 75 years. No other private company or public company has to do this. They created this so there'll be a crisis saying that they don't have the funding. And they had to come up with this money in 10 years or so. So it was a fabricated crisis by somebody that actually owns UPS stores. Not UPS, but the UPS franchise stores. So it's attacked. Why are they attacking the public sector worker? I mean, they're attacking everybody, but they're attacking the public sector because they have higher union density and they want to get corporate profit over the public services. And, you know, things should be, and certain things, whether, you know, you don't have to be a leftist to think that some things should be in the public domain. Like, for example, the fire department, okay? You know, there's some places they're actually privatizing. It didn't work here in Chicago. You guys remember this little fire we had back in the day? When allegedly they tried to blame a poor cow for kicking over a lantern? You know, the city basically burned down because they had private firemen. So what would happen is these firemen from two different fire stations would show up. Well, I mean, these two different gangs, I mean, two different fire stations. They would show up with axes and they would fight over who was going to put out the fire because that's who's going to get paid. You know, so I mean, certain things should be, you know, public sector in the public domain. You know, not everything should be profit. I don't think anything should be profit. But even capitalists should understand that some things shouldn't be for profit. And the post office shouldn't is one of these things that shouldn't be for profit. So there was a lot of other struggles going on too. I mean, this was, you know, we're living in very interesting times. I mean, with the economy collapsing in around 2008, you know, I was there, if anybody remembers Republic Windows, okay? When Republic Windows broke down, they tried to, when all that came out, I was there on day two inside the Occupy Factory with Dunkin' Donuts and coffee, man. It was amazing. I thought the revolution was here almost, you know. I thought something was going to happen. But, you know, Obama, before he went into office, he was for him, you know. It was just like a lot of those politicians. They're for something before they're against it or vice versa, you know. If they change their mind because of facts, you know, and they learn something, that's one thing. But lots of times it's just whatever's politically expedient. But anyhow, when this all happened, what they're doing is trying to move the factory, close it down, and move all the equipment to somewhere else, you know. And the workers were hip to it, so they caught wind of it, and they occupied the factory. You know, and they fought back and won, you know, because they didn't want to give them their severance pay, they didn't want to do nothing. So, and eventually, you know, the people that owned the factory got caught, not because they were trying to rip off the workers, but they were trying to rip off the banks because they were saying they're closing, going bankrupt. They're actually trying to move to Iowa and bring all their equipment over there. So those people are in jail, locked up in jail now. And now, last thing I heard is, you know, one thing is they reopened the factory, another company bought it, so they were working, got some of the people back to work. That quite didn't work out because they didn't want to listen to the workers of how they should run the company. You know, because, I mean, I don't need a boss to tell me what to do. I think I've been doing this for UPS 25 years. I know my job. People I work with know my job. People that work at the factory knew it. They were big. It was good enough that they got a company to buy it, to reopen it back up. But they tried to run it a different way than it was run before, and it didn't work, you know. So now the last thing I heard is being reopened, and the workers are going to own it, and it's going to be run that way. And hopefully this can kind of be a successful thing. I'm going to see about getting some windows, if they're going to come out to the south suburbs over here and see if they want to put some windows in my house. But I just saw last time I saw Armando Robles, that one of the guys in the UE union that was involved with the strike, it was in the process, so I need to touch base with him. But hey, if anybody needs some windows, try to, you know, get them from the former, you know, Republic Windows. Maybe you could call the local UE hall, they might have some more information. But, you know, if you want to leave in contact with me over a few different things I'm going to be talking about, I'll get back with you on it. Okay, so we had this postal struggle, and they beat back the attacks by organizing the people. You know, the Postmaster General said it was a done deal, you know, about stopping the 6-day. It's not a done deal. They stopped it. But it's kind of like the sequester, austerity, all this nonsense. It's going to be coming back, you know, and there's some bills coming up. You know, it's kind of put off. So it's still in the works, you know what I mean? I'm going to be updating you next year about what happened, probably, you know, how it goes. And there's also some other struggles going on with AFSCME. They had their contract negotiations. They want to close mental health facilities. So it's still more attacks on the public sector. You know, they beat back the tax. My understanding is they got their contract and everything like that. But there's all these different struggles, these interesting times. When the economy crashed, people, you know, when the banksters crashed the housing market, you know, with its derivatives, I'm going to maybe go a little off, but it's Glass-Steagall. They created this Glass-Steagall after the Great Depression to regulate banking and separate commercial banking from investment banking. So they couldn't, you know, use like derivatives. They couldn't use like people's mortgages for somebody else to invest in. And that's what crashed the economy. You know, they sold loans to people who knew they couldn't pay. They didn't care because they were going to sell that as an investment package to somebody else. They sold it to somebody else. And then the last person got caught with a bag, you know, and then it all went under. You know, and we need to blame the people at the top. You know, the people that created it. Who doesn't want to have a nice house? You know what I mean? And, you know, they put this out on TV. You know, I mean, it's like from the time, you know, people are kids. You know, these little girls see Barbie, right? And she got the Barbie car, and she sees the Barbie house. And they're like, man, that bitch got everything, you know? So I mean, everybody wants some nice stuff, you know? So, I mean, that's the way it's sold, you know? It's too, you know, everybody wants to have a comfortable life, you know? But it's too commercialized, and, you know, they try to sell this to people. Okay. But, yeah. But the struggle, I mean, all across the public sector, people are fighting back the attacks, you know, and then we got the Fight for 15 campaign in the public sector, okay? Now, on Black Friday, there was a Walmart strike, you know, in the city of Chicago and all across the country. I was there while we were striking Walmart, and we went out to the first facility, so we were marching in front of Walmart, and then we ended up in front of the entrance, and we kind of sort of accidentally on purpose didn't know which way to go when we were marching, so we had a caucus there, and nobody could get in or out of the Walmart, you know, so until the police showed up and helped us figure out which way we had to go. Thankfully for them, you know. And so then we hit the next Walmart, you know. And so when we got to that Walmart, the police were already there, and so we were shown, you know, where to go, you know, to march on the sidewalk, you know, not, you know, in front of the entrance and ever. So we marched out of the parking lot. We were able to get into the parking lot, but we had to march out and on the street. By the time we got to the third Walmart, the FBI was waiting for us there. You know, so it might have been like a guy, you know, that was behind a desk and got no better to do, you know, getting close to retirement. But there was one FBI guy there, and the police were there. And what they did is block the entrance to stop our bus from going there. So what they did is they did our work for us. They had all the entrances of the Walmart blocked with the police cars, and none of the customers could get into the Walmart. So that worked out pretty well. So we were standing in front of the Walmart just waving people on like we're directing traffic. You know, after a while, the police finally figured it out. You know, they're pretty... pretty smart group of guys, you know. They figured out that they should move their cars and let the customers in eventually. So we had a very eventful day, you know, in the Walmart strike. And then after that, we had a little lunch. And, we got some new t-shirts there. For the ladies. Wow. Okay, so anyhow, they have the Fight for 15 campaign. Okay, now what they're doing is fighting for $15 an hour in urban areas, you know, I mean, for every job, whether it's McDonald's, Starbucks, you know, Macy's, wherever you're at, whether it's retail, food, whatever. And if you're in an urban area, these are companies that are, you know, national or multinational companies that are billion-dollar companies making all these profits. You know, they're fighting for a $15 an hour minimum wage where there's these areas with very high cost of living. You know, so it's a Fight for 15 campaign. You know, so then after that we went down to, I think it might have been a Macy's, but man, I went to three Walmarts that day. You know, and it was Black Friday. And since then, I've been to so many darn protests in between. But I think it was a Macy's. And it was a Fight for 15 campaign that we're out there, you know, supporting the workers, the retail workers, fighting for the campaign for $15. So, now that being said, okay, on the UPS contract, we fought for $14 an hour in 1997, and we got 50 cents. We moved up from 8 to 8.50. Now, if what year is it? In 2013, and the international is fighting to increase the starting pay to UPS in a tentative agreement to $10. And I'm going to tell you how that's not really a $1.50 increase like they'd like to say when I talk more particular about it. But shouldn't we be fighting for at least 15 if people aren't even in a union can step up and fight for $15 an hour? You know, they haven't been a part of a union that they should be educated and knowledgeable that the union leadership educated the membership. Oh, wait a second, that doesn't happen too often. You know, so... You know, it's like at UPS, we got a clause in the contract for union orientation, okay? You know, and I don't think the business agent has ever done one of those. I don't think any previous steward has ever done that. Once they got their 40 days, I give, you know, all my Teamsters a union orientation. I kind of, you know, break it down to them about the union and try to educate them the best I can. Maybe even the point, you know, where they're done here, they had enough of hearing me talk, you know what I mean? But I let them, they can't say they, you know, can't say they heard about the union.
No,
so the thing is, what we need to do is have an educated membership, you know, that, yeah, we deserve, you know, $15 an hour. We deserve more than that. I mean, if the minimum wage kept up with inflation I was reading, you know, it would be 13 something an hour. That was a long time ago when I read that. So I don't, it'd be much more than that. It's like our wages at UPS. If they kept up with inflation since 1997, we would be making, the part-timers would be making $19 an hour to start. So prices keep on going up, but wages remain flat. You know, that was basically the, you know, a depression. When you have a recession, a period of recovery, where corporations recover, but wages remain flat. And then another recession, what do we call that? We call that a depression. Anyhow, so we got non-union workers supported by unions, activists, fighting for $15 an hour. So, I mean, that's tribute, the very least that, you know, they're fighting for in the UPS contract. Oh, can't forget, another thing in the labor movement, the Congress Hotel. The Congress Hotel, the longest running strike, active strike in American history, is over. That's my understanding. They made an unconditional offer to go back to work. Some people are going back, some are not. But I've been going on that strike for years. They're having the yearly rallies. I got into it with the scabs on many occasions. I guess they called the police on me once, but I was gone before the police showed up. So I've been involved in that struggle for years, visiting the Congress Hotel. Whenever I went downtown, take the Metro, boom, I stopped, walked their picket line. You know, I was always out there supporting them, fighting the good fight, send a message to all the other hotels that, you know, they're going to fight for the wages and benefits, and they're going to be out there 10 years fighting for it, if that's what's necessary. So when I started put that down, I was like, holy smokes, You know, that is like the Hyatt. And it's the same union that's united here. They're fighting for a campaign. They had to unite here and they had to split. But they're fighting for, there's a campaign against the Hyatt Hearst and stuff like that. And if I get time, boom, put that in. It's part of, I got some of the literature from their campaign. When I was running my sticker campaign at UPS, I got some information. But what's going on there is they're actually trying to run a Hyatt worker for the board in Hyatt. So they're going out to the board meetings and they're actually running somebody for the Hyatt to put somebody on the Hyatt board who's actually a worker so they can hear the concerns of the worker. But there's the struggle at the Hyatt hotels going on right now. So there's all kinds of labor strikes. If you're involved in support unions, pick one. You know, I say, hey, come out here and support the Teamsters on the UPS, Teamsters UPS contract campaign. Okay. So now, what everybody's been waiting for, right?
Not me taking off.
No, I wasn't talking about taking my shirt off. I was talking about the UPS contract.
Yes.
Can I ask you a question?
Not yet.
But anyhow, here's another nice sign how signs are so important. This is a sign from the 1997 strike. UPS, tightest slave ship in the business. Now, you see there's no Teamster logo. This is like an unofficial picket sign. Man, they didn't like it so much, you know. But I was able to acquire one of these from, it fell off the back of a truck, is what we like to say in the Teamsters industry.
Good. Yeah, you got a problem with that?
Yeah, that's another thing we say. Okay, so, that sign was underpaid slaves, you know. And that was out in 97, we're making $8 an hour. And now it's $8.50 an hour. How many years later is that? 1997? Holy smokes. Well, yeah, it's basically minimum wage. Minimum wage is in Illinois is $8.25. The starting pay at UPS is $8.50. And I understand the benefits of being in a union. I got Teamster tattooed on my knuckles. UPS would have done fired me if they could. I mean, I've been taken out of service. They tried to fire me three times. Been taken out of service. You know, I've been threatened, you know, to be fired, and, you know, leave the building, all kinds of good stuff all the time, you know. And so I understand the value of a union, you know, and I'm just more than just protecting my job, but a lot of other things. But somebody coming in into UPS, making $8.50 an hour, you know, just 25 cents more than minimum wage in Illinois, and then have to pay union dues, you know what I mean? It's kind of, and they're just trying to make an effort to raise the initiation fees to part-timers in our local. And I stopped it, you know, basically almost single-handedly. I had a few people speaking on the mic with me, but they wanted to raise the initiation fees. But the starting pay hasn't, you know, their excuse was the initiation fees haven't gone up for years. Well, the starting pay hasn't gone up for years either. You know what I mean? When the starting pay goes up, you know, I won't have as much of an issue with it. But they wanted to raise the initiation fees. And what they did is then filed a proper procedure. They didn't, in our bylaws, you're supposed to give timely notice. They did not give notice in this particular bylaw change. So I let let them know, the head of the union know. He disagreed with me, but then when push came to shove at the meeting, he had it tabled. Then at the third meeting for the bylaws, he decided, you know, not to go forward with it because he knew it wasn't timely. You know, he didn't follow the bylaws and everything like that, so I stopped it. Probably going to go forward next year, but there's supposed to be an increase in the starting pay. Technically, there's going to be an increase in the starting pay. Okay. So now, what's going on right now is the national vote on the UPS contract is out around the country. Okay. It's a concessionary contract, and the ballots were sent out, and they're going to be voting on it June 20th. So out there in internet land, you know, if you get a chance to see me, don't stop campaigning for the Vote No. There's a Vote No campaign going on. And, you know, it's all over the country. Wherever there's TDU members, and I'll let you know what TDU is in a moment. Wherever there's TDU members or other activists, there's a Vote No campaign going on. In particular, in Louisville, okay, in Louisville, actually, the executive board and the stewards recommended a vote no. Now, the international office, the international officers are telling it was unanimous that, you know, the two-man team from every local unanimously supported the contract, which was a lie. People in Louisville are recommending a vote no. The executive board and the stewards are recommending the vote no. So then, what did UPS do? UPS countered with $1,000, $1,000 bribe to every voting member in Louisville to vote yes. So that kind of shows you, they didn't even vote no yet. They just recommended a vote no, and UPS offered $1,000 cash. I like to have more in the contract, you know what I mean? Because, you know, that $1,000 up in smoke, but it just says what UPS will do. If they actually vote no, they're going to put a better offer on the table. That's what's going to happen. So everybody around the country, you know, they need to vote no on this contract, make UPS put a better offer on the table. And so what UPS is doing over there, they offered that $1,000. They're having, and they're actually, the international is in cahoots with the company trying to sell the contract, okay? The international has sent an unprecedented 3 mailings to recommend a vote yes around the country, okay? And UPS is getting out slick materials, actually telling the members to vote no. They're having one-on-one meetings as well as group meetings with the members in Louisville on company time trying to sell this contract. But I think it's going to get, a vote no is going to happen in Louisville because it's recommended, you know, by the stewards and the e-board because it carries weight. I'm not saying this guy is a reformer or anything like that, and he probably has aspirations to run for office again, you know, against Hoffa. But still, he's doing the right thing by, you know, organizing the membership and fighting back. So leadership is very important, but we need a rank and file leadership, you know. That's really going to fight. Otherwise, you know, people will do whatever is politically expedient. Okay. Now, yeah, so let me get into this TDU. Like I was talking about, wherever there's TDU. I'm a member of TDU, Teamsters for a Democratic Union. Because of TDU, we won the right to vote. Okay, and I voted in the first Teamster election. I know, the Teamster has been around in 100 years, and I got to vote in the first Teamster election for international officers. In 1991, I voted for the first time members actually got to vote in an international election for the officers. This came about because of the organization, TDU. It was almost a 20-year struggle for the right to vote. You know, I mean, this guy got his head busted, you know, by people didn't want them to have the right to vote, if you will, you know. Fighting for that struggle almost 20 years. Then I got to vote in the first Teamster election. We elected Ryan Carey, and in 96 he got reelected, and in 97 we went on strike in UPS. He was the kind of leadership that mobilized the membership. That he was elected because of TDU, a rank and file movement. He wouldn't have had the opportunity to be elected. And democracy is power, because that's going to be the kind of leadership. It comes from the rank and file that's going to fight for the rank and file. You know, we need an active membership, we need stewards, business, we need everybody working together, you know. An army of sheep led by a lion will beat an army of lions led by a sheep. So, I mean, we need a kind of leader that's going to mobilize the membership and be of and for the members. So in 97, we went on strike. In that strike, you know, we did a variety of tactics, you know, and these are the kind of tactics that we need. There's a book called Reviving the Strike. And in that book, it talks about all the different tactics, you know, but the most important, you know, tactic is stopping production. And the most important thing is, we had exercises, you know, in steward meetings, but what's the most important thing, you know, in a strike, and it's mobilizing the membership, the unity, the solidarity. And with that, you know, then the most important tactic is stopping production. And it talks about how we need to stop production to win strikes. And all these tactics, you know, there's other tactics that go along with it, but in this day and age, all the tactics that we're allowed to do legally, you know, a watered down version of the old tactics. You know, because they made everything illegal that's affected. You know, the secondary boycott, striking along the supply chain, other companies. You know, a lot of different things. They make illegal things that are successful. You know, sabotage, you know, occupying plants, that kind of thing, and make it illegal. But, you know, to win in this day and age, you might have to break the law. You know, but the TDU is a rank and file movement. We're for, you know, better wages and benefits. We're for better contracts. We're for enforcing contracts. We're for your union democracy. Because union democracy brings power to the union. You know, it brings in people who, you know, who are active and involved and want to win and want to fight back. You know, and the members have a say. Okay, so that's a little bit about TDU. And because of that leadership, we'll talk about what we won in 97, okay? We won 10,000 full-time jobs in 1997 when we went on strike. We won a 50-cent increase in the starting pay. We asked for 14, we got 50 cents. And we won an extra half an hour guarantee for the part-timers. Okay, the part-timers only have a guaranteed 3 hours before then. Now they got a guaranteed 3.5 hours. So, I know, so that hasn't changed either, but guaranteed 3.5. And another thing we did is we stopped UPS from pulling out of the pension. They wanted to pull out the pensions. So that's kind of, you know, that was something UPS was pushing. We beat back, that was like on the defense, and they beat back their attacks. But we made some serious gains. Since then, you know, we basically lost most of that. And one, it matters how you look at it, but like, the last contract, we did not get any 10,000 full-time jobs, no full-time jobs in the national contract. Our local got 500 full-time jobs on paper, but they have to get them to us before the end of the contract. Well, it expires August 1st. And so, I don't know, I'd like to hear something from our local if, you know, we got any of these 500 full-time jobs yet. You know, we shouldn't even sit down and meet and negotiate with the company until they give us what we got in the previous contract. We shouldn't be negotiating over what we already won, you know. But so I mean, that's kind of, you know, what we won and what we and another thing is, okay, so we haven't got a raise. We got a 50 cent raise in 97. I mean, in the starting pay, we haven't got a raise in the starting pay since up until now. Okay, we haven't got the 10,000 full time jobs. We're offering a couple thousand in this particular contract. But, okay, we have more than 2,500 facilities. So actually, we got more facilities than jobs, full-time jobs we're offering. So that means a lot of facilities aren't even going to get one full-time job. And the bigger facilities might get a few. So, I mean, it's still less than the 10,000 we got in 97. Okay, another thing is, in the last contract, they let the let UPS pull out of Central States pension for a one-time payment that went up in smoke with this economic collapse. That money's gone, so the Central States is hurting. And a little bit about pensions. They've got a lot of laws in this country, and I'm all for laws. Get the best laws in book we can. Get the best politicians in office we can, whatever that's worth. But whenever you hear these laws, you're going to hear all these nice-sounding names, like the Patriot Act. Doesn't that sound nice? You know, I mean, that's, I don't want to go off on that tangent, but it's we got something called the Pension Protection Act. Yeah, I look at it as the Patriot Act for the pensions, you know, because what it is, it creates these arbitrary zones, different color zones, and because of that, we have to cut payments, you know, cut stuff for retirees. So, I mean, it doesn't protect pensions at all, you know, for the most part. I mean, when there's something, you know, some finances are bad, whatever. But, for example, we don't need pensions funded 100%. That's what UPS likes to say. They got pensions. You know, when UPS has a pension, it'll be funded 100%. But why? Because it's paying less in benefits. UPS pensions pay less. The members care what's getting paid in benefits. Of course, you got to have enough funding down the road. But most people don't have enough money to buy their house cash money, okay? So what they do is have a mortgage, and they pay it over time. As they get money comes in, they pay. That's how pensions work. You know, they're usually not 100% funded. They, They're partially funded, and they pay as you go along. Like Social Security wasn't pay as you go, but now it's funded up for so many years, and they're trying to say that as a problem. That's only when they actually has money in the bank. A lot of other programs is we're actually not paying as you go, but deficit spending for like the military and wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. You know, we're borrowing money for that, and it's not on the books. You know, so actually, you know, there's a surplus. There's a surplus in Social Security. And in the post office, they want them to fund them for 75 years. Yeah, how you know, nobody else has to do that. So all these things are fabricated financial crises created by, you know, the bosses, to put it, you know, put it in the simplest terms. Okay. And so, yeah, so now, with this new contract, you know, the bad things about this new contract. And now, what they're saying is, the starting pay is going to increase to $10 in this new contract. Well, guess what? That's going to be knocking on the door of minimum wage, you know, by the time 2018 comes by. And actually, the minimum wage on some tip, in some states, is actually more than the starting pay at UPS. So they actually had to raise the starting pay at UPS because of the minimum wage. You know, I think it's Washington, if I'm not mistaken, probably some urban cities as well. And so... so increasing the starting pay looks so magnanimous when they actually have to anyway because minimum wage is going up. Like Durbin's talking about raising it to 10, Obama's talking about 9, something, whatever. So he was talking, Obama was talking about a higher minimum wage, of course, before he got in office, though. But anyway, so they're increasing the starting pay to $10 in a tentative agreement. So that sounds really nice. But let me break it down. Okay, the starting pay at UPS is $8.50 an hour. They get a dollar raise in 90 days, right, in the current contract. Well, what they're going to do now is get rid of that raise in 90 days, the dollar raise in 90 days. So basically, technically, the starting pay is going up $1.50, but they're actually just moving that raise up 90 days. So after 90 days of working, they're only going to be making 50 cents more than in the previous contract since 97. Now, here's another thing. There's going to be another takeaway. So it's probably going to only be an increase in 13 cents when by the time it's done. Now, people who are in the contract before, people who already have seniority prior to the contract will get these raises of 70 cents, 70 cents, 70 cents, and then it's going to be split 40-40 and 50-50 over the course of the year. I'll get into that split raise thing too. But, now, the people that come in after the contract gets a 50-cent raise, 50-cent raise, 50-cent raise, fourth year, 87 cents. In the new contract, it's 50 cents 4 years in a row. So what that means, they're taking away 30 cents. So after working 4 years at UPS, they're only going to be making 13 cents more than the people made 4 years after 97 or so in... 2001. So basically, it amounts to a 13-cent raise after working 4 years. So that's their big gain that the international is talking about that they won for the part-timers. A 13-cent raise after 4 years. Okay, another thing is the issue, the health insurance. They want to raise the health insurance to the retirees. First thing they did is attack our health insurance, said they wanted us to pay $30 a week for a single, $60 for a spouse, $90 for a family plan, and it's going to go up every year. Okay, currently we pay no premiums. Now, currently, retirees pay $50. I feel they shouldn't have to pay shit. They built this union, and they worked hard for it, and everything, you know, I got before came from their hard work. And I've been around a minute, so I walked the line in 97, so I a lot of people, you know, well, I fought for in 97. I don't want them to take away from us. Okay, so they want to raise it now to $150 for a single and $300 for a spouse with no family coverage for the retirees. You know, and that might not be as much, you know, as some people are paying, but not everybody works for UPS, a company that made over $4 billion last year in after taxes profit. That's money, you know, that's their going out drinking money, you know what I mean? That's their extra money that they got. Now, in this current contract, in this current year, they're on pace to make more money than last year, to get closer to $5 billion. So they're on pace with record, you know, with almost record-breaking profits. before the economic collapse. Since then, they're making a killing, on our backs, on our sweat and blood. So who do they want to jack it to? They want to jack it to the unborn, the people who aren't working at UPS, that don't vote. And then they want to jack it to the people, who are retired, who don't vote for the contract. So, and I guess it's politically expedient for the union officials not to care about the unborn and not to care about the retirees, because neither of them vote for a contract, neither of them vote for in the union elections. So sometimes, we need a little bit, reform in the union. I'm all for a union. Like, I got a Teamster tattooed on my knuckles. That's the last thing they're going to see before they're knocked out. Okay, so anyway, yay. Now, so I talked about, one more thing about the 97 contract. We actually got a $6 raise over 5 years, okay? And that included catch-up pay for the part-timers. The current contract is 70 cents, 70 cents, 70 cents. 80 cents over a year, they're going to get 40 in August, 40 in February. Our raises are delayed 6 months, and it's 50-50. So that amounts to $3.90. The last contract was $4 over 5 years. Now, Ken Hall, he's the number two guy in the Teamsters. He's the head of the small package division, so that's basically UPS.
Thank you.
He said, the more UPS makes, the more we take. So he doesn't mean them for the members, that's for sure, because the raises are smaller. So he must have meant for him and Junior Hoffa, because he didn't mean for us. Okay, so what we'd actually need to keep up with inflation, we need 440 over 5 years just to keep up with inflation. Now, what they're doing is rearranging the chairs on the Titanic. Okay, because they're going to give us 390 over 5 years instead of the $4. But there's a change, because in the last contract, we had split raises for the 5 years. So now they're going to say, we only have split raises for two of the 5 years. So they're just rearranging the chairs in the Titanic, they did that, so it looked like they did something, but actually we're getting less overall. Then they can argue, say, we get $1 one year. Yeah, but all the other years we're getting less raises on the other end. So that's the issue with the raises. So what they're trying to do is make it look like we're getting a lot more raises than we're actually getting. Okay. Now, the big elephant in the room, though, is the health care issue. If I didn't say it before, I got to say it again. I got to reiterate this. This is the crux of the vote no, where more and more people will probably vote no. I mean, all these issues are serious issues. Oh, one more issue. They want to increase the progression for the drivers. So after keeping people part-time all these years, once you become a full-time worker, okay, the current contract is 3 years to get the full-time pay. Previous one was 2.5. In the new contract, they want to charge. I want to take 4 years to get up to full-time pay. So what they want, 5 years next time? So they want to increase the length of time that these workers are going to be at a lower pay scale before making full-time pay. 40 days you're in the union, 40 days you should, be up to the pay. That's what I say. I'd be wanting from the get-go, but hey, I'm being reasonable. 40 days. Okay, so the big issue, though, is the health insurance. This is going to be the vote now. I mean, I'm talking about, they want to raise, our local already agreed we're going to set the same raise as national. Our local already said it's inevitable to raise insurance on our retirees. None of this is inevitable. But big elephant in the room is the health insurance. UPS is not going to provide the health insurance, not going to be the minister of the health insurance for people who work at UPS. 140,000 Teamsters are going to go on a C6 enhanced plan. Initially, it was just a C6 plan, which was so bad, actually, local union officials are beholden to the IBT, rebelled against it, because if they didn't do something, the people wouldn't vote them in office locally anymore if they didn't fight back against this. So they came up with a C6 enhanced plan. Okay, so these 140,000 Teamsters are going to be put into the C6 enhanced plan, which has inferior benefits to the current UPS health insurance. Okay, it's gonna be a $400 deductible, higher co-pays, a higher prescription cost, and an inferior dental plan. Now, so the 140,000 Teamsters are gonna be in. Some locals are trying to come up with their own plan. 705 actuaries are looking at their own health insurance. We have a health and welfare plan, so we provide health insurance for members whose companies don't. We just negotiate how much money the company would put into it, you know, and what we need is, and we need to do the same thing at UPS. We need to negotiate how much money UPS would put into it, but we also need to have a maintenance of benefits. That means when the cost goes up, not if, that it would be covered. Otherwise, you know, we would have to, you know, end up falling on the members. So I'm not against having the Teamster health insurance plan, but I don't want to have reduced benefits. Okay, so if we get stuck in the C6 enhanced plan, I'm running a vote no campaign. There's people out here running it with me. We're going to see if more people get active and involved, like all across the country. This shirt I got right here. Got another shirt here, huh? Oh man, got this vote no shirt over here, and I got this, if I didn't mention it before, if I did, I'm saying it again. I got this from the vote no campaign in Philadelphia. You know, they got a website up, it says vote no on the UPS contract. They got a Facebook page. Well, they got this up and running over there. There's a vote no campaign in Tampa. They got an article in the paper, Fight Back, in different, you know, all different places all around the country. In New York, they recommended a vote no. You know, it wasn't unanimous. They recommended a vote no on a national. But in their supplement, they negotiated. They're gonna negotiate expedited arbitration. This is something we won in our last contract, where if UPS is trying to fire somebody, we got a grievance procedure, right? And you know, they cannot, you know, fire anybody unless it's a cardinal sin. It has to go through the grievance procedure. But if it's a cardinal sin, they're taken out of service. And they can wait a year or two while the company, you know, breaks them financially. And they're willing to come back, you know, on a last chance agreement with no back pay. Now we got expedited arbitration. A month, two at the most, they're going to get their hearing. So they can know either way that they're, you know, we have a sitting arbitrator. So they know either way if they have their job and it's settled. They can either move on with their life or, you know, where's that? Or go postal or whatever. They can make up their mind what they're going to do, you know, and they don't have to wait a year or two. So they were able to get expedited arbitration. But so this vote no campaign is going on all around the country. Stay strong on it. If you're out there listening to this on the vote no campaign, don't stop. You know, keep on, you know, campaigning for the vote no and until it's done with. You know, don't give up and, you know, and pass the vote no. I actually vote no. And so what that do will make you guys put a better offer on the table. So now, you know, the union officials are sweating me a little bit about this vote no campaign. You don't even know what's in the contract. Well, like I said, they already agreed that the raise is going to be the same national. They already said the insurance is going up for the retirees. So if the insurance goes up for the retirees, we got to connect the dots for people. It doesn't just affect the people who are about to retire or the people who are retired. You know, it affects everybody. Because for every year, I got to work longer, right? They raise it $100. For every $100 they raise it, it means I got to work another year to get another $100 a month in my pension. So what does that mean? That's another year before a full-time job opens up for a part-timer. Got to connect the dots. One thing affects the other. So that's the elephant in the room. Basically, this health insurance, the C6 enhanced plan. Our local said we're going to make UPS pay if we get stuck in the C6 enhanced plan, because our actuaries are looking at the numbers. We're trying to create our own. You know, we, like I said, but if we don't, that's a fallback, and they said we're going to make UPS pay. I don't know. I mean, we have like a saying in 705, you know, they ask us, hey, who are we? Then, you know, our reply is, 705, motherfucker. But you know, that seems like a lot of tough talk. What's that?
A local.
Teamsters local 705. You know, it seems like a lot of tough talk, though. Unless, you know, what we're gonna do, how are we gonna make UPS pay? You know, I mean, the thing is, people want, you know, health insurance. They worked hard. UPS is working hard. We're gonna need that health insurance. We're gonna need it now. We're gonna need it when I retire. You know, and I almost forgot to talk about this. Man, okay, I'm going to go off on a tangent, but this is important. And Charlie was there with me, you know, on this tip. Okay. In 2008, well, prior to 2008, the Democratic primary in Soldier Field, I got a ticket. You know, must have fell off the back of a truck to the debate. The debate at the Soldier Field, the Democratic primary. Okay. There, you know, people might say, oh, they saw Barack Obama speak there. Well, you know, whoop-de-doo, all right. I saw Dennis Kucinich speak there. He had a program. He talked about single-payer health care. He actually had a program in saying what he was going to do when he was elected. That was one of the things in his program. Obama, you know, did a lot of good feel-good talk, you know, tell people what they want to hear, blow some smoke up people's ass, whatever you want to call it, you know. But he didn't really give us no, you know, concrete what he's going to do. So after I heard Dennis Kucinich speak, you know, okay, I went on campaign for him. That day I was, you know, I was like, you know, going around Soldier Field. Somebody said, asked me if I was his son. You know, I was so pumped up, you know, that he actually had a program. So I was involved campaigning with Charlie over there for Dennis Kucinich. Well, what happened? Okay, Obama got elected, we got Obamacare. And I was telling people about Obamacare. I mean, I don't want to have to say I told you so, but I was speaking as much as I can to whoever wanted to hear, talking about single payer, talking about how Obamacare is going to affect unions. And that's why we got this attack on our health care. Because in Obamacare, what they do is they're going to tax premium health care plans, Cadillac plans at 40%. Now, they haven't defined what the dollar amount is for these Cadillac plans. But, you know, UPS is so afraid, whatever, that their plan is going to be taxed at 40%. That's going to cost them. They attacked us with this 30, 60, 90 that I talked about. So then, you know, between the union and the company, they figured out the Teamster is going to run the health care plan. So what happens if we're a premium plan? The union is going to be charged that 40% tax on the plan. That's why they came so hard, because it's Obama health care plan. So that's why, I mean, I'm still advocating for single payer. What did I do? In our local, I made a motion, and I had another Teamster brother second it, and it was passed by the membership that our local supports single payer health care. Okay, so we did that over there. I did what I could on that. It went out to the national single payer email thing that they put out. You know, they put out all these different locals and state AFL-CIOs that endorsed it. But Obama's backed by Hoffa. He backed the single payer. That's what union officials do. They usually back the most, the Democrat that's most likely to get elected. Not the most progressive or the most labor friendly, but the most one that's most likely to get elected. So they backed Obamacare. Now they're being a little, you know, they're backtracking a little bit on it. And part of it is because there's going to be exemptions for business. You know, and businesses will be able to get out of providing the health care and pay this really small fine, which is a lot less than the cost of the health care. But the union is not going to have the same loopholes as the corporation. So that's a big thing that the union is fighting against. Not so much that it's going to be taxed at 40%, because I guess they don't think that far ahead. They don't look at the big picture, but these corporations are looking at the big picture. We got to be playing a chess game. They said that Obama's playing a chess game. He threw out the thing to get rid of, you know, the chain CPI, the Social Security. That ain't how to negotiate. Obama doesn't know how to negotiate. Hoffa doesn't know how to negotiate. Junior Hoffa. He doesn't know how to negotiate. He never ran a local. He never worked for a living. He was a corporate lawyer. You know, I guess, you know, a person's father wants to see better for his kid, so his kid never had to work a day in his life. Then he come in there, become the, you know, the head of the international union with no ability to fight back. That's why we need rank and file leadership. So after this campaign is done, I'm going day one. When I started the UPS contract campaign, December 31st, 2011. So I was working on getting us a better contract, and I'm still working on getting a better contract. I got the listserv up and running. You know, I created, you know, different, on, you know, there's things on Facebook for it, Union Book, LinkedIn, Twitter, Flickr, Tumblr, all across the social media, getting out all kinds of flyers, one-on-one conversations, you know, trying to build a campaign for a better contract. Well, this time, I'm going to do it August 2nd. I'm going to be basically telling people to vote no on the next contract. vote no on the next contract if the same administration's in office nationally and otherwise. So what it's going to take is a rank and file movement, you know, to get union, get people in office. Like, when this is over, we need to prepare to run somebody for office and get Hoffa Jr., Junior Hoffa, or his, or whoever's going to follow in his footsteps, Ken Hall, to get them out of office. We need to build an organization like CORE, where it's union members and people who want to support people in the Teamsters at UPS. So if anybody wants to support and provide support, you know, see me about getting involved in the Chicago Labor Solidarity Campaign. See me, maybe we need to create another organization in addition to TDU to support people at UPS and the UPS contract. And we need to get the leadership, the Sandy Popes, the Tom Leadhams, whoever. We need to get a good, and I don't got time to talk about running a campaign for office for those people, but we need to get the leadership we need. But it's going to have to be a rank and file, whichever form it takes, whether it's non-union workers for fighting for $15 an hour, whether it's people inside and outside, whether it's Occupy. What we need is a rank and file, bottom-up, democratically run organizations, because change is not going to come from the top. One other thing, okay, there was a couple things in the struggle, in my personal struggle, for this contract campaign at UPS. I came to work wearing the In Part-Time Poverty shirts. They didn't know what to make of it, so I got the stickers, the In Part-Time Poverty stickers out of the break. So then management come up to me and said, you know, were you handing out stickers? He was there watching me, so he was trying to get me to be dishonest. So I said, yeah, I was handing them out. Then he came to me and said, you know, people are vandalizing the building. First of all, I told him I'm not responsible what people are doing with the stickers. Second of all, we scan packages, and there's all these spot labels. If you ever saw UPS packages, there's this little spot label that gets scanned. It gets, a lot of them come off, get stuck all over people's clothes. So I said, hey, you guys are vandalizing UPS members' clothes with these spot labels. What you going to do about that? And then he walks off. So the next day, I only had one t-shirt at the time. And now I got like, you know, I got like five, six, seven t-shirts. I got one for every day of the week, and I got one with the sleeves cut off when I go out to the different buildings in this warm, because I'm not allowed to wear sleeveless shirts. So I'm wearing the sticker. They told me I had to take off the sticker or I had to leave the building. So I told them I didn't have to take off the sticker. They sent me home. I went home, sent out my emails like I do, then went to another UPS facility and handed out hundreds of stickers. So this was at the night shift, so the union hall wasn't open to contact. TDU wasn't open. So next morning when I start, you know, just the same thing. TDU is not open. The union hall is not open at 4 a.m. I'm wearing a sticker. They threaten to send me home if I don't take it off. I tell them I'm not taking it off. And they threaten to have me arrested and escorted out of the building. So I'm getting my stuff first. So I went home, sent out some more emails. Then I went to another UPS facility, got out hundreds of more stickers. And then I talked to TDU. They said it's, because they were trying to say it's a copyright infringement and does UPS harm. First of all, I don't care. I told them I don't care if it does UPS harm. And it's not a copyright infringement. I called TDU. They told me it's not a copyright infringement. They sent me a bunch of email material through the email, a bunch of examples how there's different contract campaigns and parodies protected free speech, which I already know we had shirts in previous campaigns. And then I called our union. The union agreed with me too. Both of them told me not to wear it until we go through this procedure. I turn in the stuff to the management. You know, they're going to give it to their labor manager. Time's going on. The union says, okay, if they don't get off of it, go down there and file the labor charge. I'm about to go file around the labor charge. Then their big regional labor manager or something says they don't have no problem with it. Let's work this out. A week goes by. It's still, they're stalling me. So then I wear it on Friday. And then, like I'm saying, if they send me home or tell me to take it off, I'm filing the labor charge. They don't say nothing. So now, down the road, I'm handing out the literature. This is actually by the union officials telling everybody how they want to charge us 30, 60, 90. I guess they wanted to tell them in that negotiation, but they didn't want the members to know what UPS wants to charge them. So they actually take a flyer away from somebody at break and reads it and gives it back to them. Another manager takes it away from a member, and I go down there to talk to the manager, how I'm telling her she can't do that. She tells me I can't hand it out. And I told her I can't hand it out, and I'm filing labor charges because I'm not going through this nonsense like they did with the stickers. I went to write the labor charges. I didn't stop handing it out. Filed NLRB charges. I won the charges. I got two postings in the building saying they can't interfere with handing the stuff out, so on and so forth. So they got slapped on the wrist. They probably won't do it again anytime soon there, because if they keep it up, they're going to be fine. But it's these little struggles. And, you know, this is an organization, TDU, and it's rank and file members that are coming out with the t-shirts. And it's not, the International had one sticker day for the healthcare. You know, one flyer day. They haven't come out shirts. They haven't, you know, they haven't really ran a contract campaign. They haven't had the parking lot rallies. They haven't, you know, they haven't had... You know, they had a minimal of any effort for a contract campaign. So everything was going to have to come from the rank and file. And if, you know, if we get a good vote no, if we get a vote no on the National, if we have a pretty good account, that'll strengthen our position and our vote no campaign here in Chicagoland. So if anybody wants to support any of that, contact with me. I'll get your information. Be involved. They'll fight for the working class.
Yes, Joe Mayor.
Joe, if let's say that the vote no campaign gets 40% of the national vote, how long do you think you will live?
Well, I'm not the only guy doing it. There's what I was able to do is organize in the Chicagoland area, 705 and 710, who negotiates their own contract. 710 is the words on the street, they're going to settle first, so I made sure I hit 710 facilities, even though I'm 705. But there's people that are in TDU and outside of TDU around the country is doing campaigns around the country. I wish I was that big of a shot, but sometimes I think they're trying to send me a message because I've been hit by semi-trucks twice. So, you know, and I get out of the semi-truck, ask them if they are right. You know, my Cavalier is almost as tough as me. But, I haven't been able to go, you know, outside of the Chicagoland area and campaign. I mean, I got my hands full organizing the people in the Chicagoland area for the vote, no.
Questions? Tim Bolger.
You know, with all the labor struggle that we've had, can you tell me why it is that most of these companies would rather see a strike rather than pay a decent wage for a decent day's work?
It almost seems like they want a strike. I mean, I've read about some lockout maybe it was in Oregon, that they locked up the International Longshoremen, that, you know, companies are going to actually use a lockout tactic more often, which is basically putting the people on strike, saying they're closing the doors if they don't agree, because they're feeling strong, they're feeling emboldened. You know, they actually, a lot of times they don't want the most of them don't want them to go on strike, but they use the strike as a weapon. It's our weapon against the employer, but they sell it to, you know, you're going to have to agree to this or the union is going to make you go on strike. They use it, it's our weapon against them, but they're using it against us. And UPS doesn't want to see a strike, and I don't think so, but I mean, some companies are willing to put the people out, make them strike, because they think they can win the strike and break the union. That's why if the union's weak, they try to put out such a bad contract which would force them to go on strike. So sometimes they have to use different tactics like an inside campaign, you know, work to rule campaign, stuff like that, because the company wants them to go on strike because they think they can win it and then break the union because they want to get rid of unions. That's why they would want a company, that's why they would go on strike, because they think they can win.
Joe, I just wanted to say I really liked what I was hearing tonight. This is wonderful what you're doing. I really support it. I'm a retired county employee, and I know a number of retired state employees. If we're in a situation where you're talking about pensions, you got the pension, what they did was wait till you finished working, and then they said, well, we're not going to make payments into your plan this year. We'll do it next year, we'll make it up to you. But he did that for 10 years, and now they're saying they've decided they never want to make the payments, and they want us to lower the pension that we're now receiving by about 21%. And I just want to tell you that, you know, they're telling us, well, the private sector is doing this, so why shouldn't we?
What's your question?
Okay, this is...
So I'd just like your comment on that.
Okay, we'll have a...
What they need to do is tax the rich. You know what I mean? They got these TIF funds, okay? It's taxpayer money. What they use is give it to business. They want to give Penny Pritzker, Obama's girlfriend, I guess, I don't know, you know, want to put her on the sixth tier, giving her a position, you know, giving her one of those positions. And she was on the Chicago School Board, but instead of giving money to the Chicago School, that's needed funding, instead of putting the money in the public sector pensions, they want to give a billionaire money to build another Hyatt, I think. Is it another Hyatt again?
Yeah.
That she owns?
But
there you go.
Not funded with pension funds, so.
There you go. And it wasn't a question, but I'm all eager to comment.
Dave Zucker, and then Dave Travis.
Yeah, what's your take on the outcome of the Congress hotel strike?
Well, they fought a good fight, you know what I mean? But it's like, I talked to Henry Tamarin, you know, and he gave me a heads up that, the strike was going to be over and stuff like that. And it showed that, you know, they're willing to stand out there and strike 10 years if they have to. But, I mean, I don't know the particulars, but, you know, just like our local, you know, when we had these little strikes and there was, you know, the best we could get is a defensive victory. They put it to the members democratically. How long do you, as long as you're willing to keep on fighting, we'll keep on supporting it. We need more multinational than that, but I mean, that's the very, at least they're doing that. So, I mean, I don't know, I didn't get enough of the particulars, even though I go out there and support them. But it might have got to the point, you know, where it was 10 years, you know, and the members were out 10 years, and they probably decided at that point that was in the best interest. They made an unconditional offer to go back to work. A lot of times, you know, it is what it is.
All right. Questions? Dave Travis.
Based on everything I've heard you say, wouldn't you just prefer that everybody became a socialist?
Well, I mean, you know, I've been called an anarcho-syndicalist, so I had to look it up on Wikipedia the first time I was called that, and it's probably closest to my beliefs. But I think we probably need to go through a stage of socialism or communism to get to that point, because people still need some structure in their life that we're not to the point where, as a people, that we're mature enough. You know, but I mean, I don't think we need bosses, but I feel we still need some kind of structure. I believe things should be democratically run by the workers. You know, I mean, I think the workers know how to do the job. And for, I mean, you know, and I know how to do my job. Everybody at my place knows their job. We can train the new people that come in. We don't need high paid people that sit in offices that don't add any value. It's my labor. Labor precedes capital. Without labor, there is no capital. Therefore, it should deserve the higher regard. It wasn't a socialist who said that. That was Abraham Lincoln. Karl Marx did send him letters. I don't know if he ever responded, but they were contemporaries. You know, but I believe we should have fair, you know, we should get rewarded for our hard work. We should have what's fair and just. I don't think it's unreasonable that if we work 8 hours a day, 25, 30 years, that we can get paid fairly, have enough money to send our kids to college, have a roof over our head, a car, food on our table, go on, have a vacation, have a secure retirement, and have health care. You know, I don't think that's unreasonable. I mean, that sounds almost like the American dream, but there want people have these aspirations to be rich, and if somebody is rich, I mean somebody else is poor. You know, and we don't need rich people, we don't need people to be poor.
Yes, Mary?
Yes, I have read statistics. It would be a vast improvement if we went back to the 1950s. What we have, you know, right now is really a travesty in terms of the maldistribution of the income that has occurred in this country. And I read nothing but bad things about that Pacific Rim Treaty that is, you know, under the radar, you know, in the news lately. But I've been following the developments on the internet from various, you know, progressive websites. And it's not good news for working people at all.
Okay.
It's just unfettered capitalism. You know, remove any kind of regulation of any kind in the name of quote, free trade, unquote. So it's all part of a bigger picture.
Well, I haven't kept up meticulously with the Pacific Rim, but what I heard about it is not good. I'm not for free trade agreements, you know. I'm for fair trade, you know. I mean, different countries that are doing well, like Germany, I wouldn't go and say terrorists because it's not exactly terrorists, but they have monetary policy and trade policies that are similar to terrorists, which would protect their own industry from, you know, things being made cheaper everywhere else. You know, while we have a system, while we have countries and system based on capitalism, we're going to need certain regulations and certain things put in place. But in general, I'm against free trade agreements. They promised that, you know, NAFTA was going to be good. It wasn't good for working folks in the United States. It wasn't good for working folks in America. It was good for the bosses in both countries. And then we got one free trade agreement after another, and none of them has been good. And I don't need to spend too much time studying this trade agreement. It's bad, you know, and free trade is we need fair trade. We need a worldwide minimum wage, you know, that something, a bottom thing that nobody can fall under, you know. Because they're just going to keep on going to whatever country can be the cheapest, you know what I mean? Okay, they went to Bangladesh and over 1,000 people died. I mean, that's the same conditions that were in the United States 100 years ago.
Yeah.
Now, what are they going to find? They're going to Mongolia, and actually has the lowest minimum wage of like 2 cents an hour or something. I don't know the estimate, right? That's the only place they got left to go, maybe, is Mongolia. Or maybe have ships, big factory ships out in the sea floating in the ocean in the international waters. I don't know.
Okay. Paul Pavlin?
I had a question about, you were talking about McDonald's, and I was wondering, do you want everybody at McDonald's to make $15 an hour?
It's a billion-dollar company. McDonald's can afford to pay $15 an hour.
Should high school students be making $15 an hour? They're starting off?
Yeah.
No. Adults should, who have a living wage. You need to work your way up.
Oh, baloney.
Oh, baloney.
Are you done?
Free labor.
Are you done?
I worked at McDonald's. I know.
He wants children working.
Equal pay for all labor is valuable. Okay, this is what happened when they used child labor. There's two reasons why union was against child labor. One, they didn't want to have their children working in the mines and getting hurt. And two, it undercut the wages of the adults working. So if they can pay people under 18 less, they're gonna work people under 18 less. They're gonna work them because it's gonna undercut wages. It's very similar to what's going on in immigration. They have the status of guest worker programs, which illegalizes the exploitation and drive down wages. On the other angle, you know, one, it undermines the wages of people over 18. But besides that, all labor is valuable. I don't care if you're under, that's ageism, you know, basically. Then we can say something about seniors. Oh, okay, you know, people can go on about, you know, well, if the senior employee wants, I'm 43, okay? I'm not going to move as fast as somebody who's 20 they just hired off the street now. Because I've been working there 25 years, my body's worn down. And there's people working 60 years old working part-time at UPS, you know? And they're not going to be able to work as fast as somebody 20. Should they get paid less? No. You know, all labor is valuable, whether you're young, whether you're old. And there should be no undercutting of wages, and it undercuts wages to pay anybody less. Whether you're a man or a woman, you can say, oh, should women get paid less? Well, I believe equal pay for equal work. If they do the same job, they should get the same pay. Or should they pay
experience,
people...
Experience should pay more, and less experience should get paid less.
Well, unskilled jobs.
It's an unskilled job, you're right.
Wait for the model.
Unskilled job at McDonald's. So if somebody who's 50 flipping a burger, she can pay more than somebody who's 17 flipping a burger, they're still flipping a burger. Same job. I mean, I believe nobody should make more than twice anybody else And, you know, I mean, so they should set up something, you know, in this country where, you know, I believe, you know, like, for example, I mean, there's to be paid according to your ability, according to your need. Like, for example, if somebody's going to put the extra training in to be a doctor or a teacher or whatever, you know, you should get paid for your labor. But, you know, if you're sweeping up, you should still get enough to support yourself and family and have a comfortable life, you know. But, it's, you know, there should be, you know, maybe the, you know, somebody works 8 hours a day, you get at least $100,000 if you push a broom. Or then if you're a doctor, you get $200,000, you know. I mean, we don't need millionaires, but I mean, I just threw a number out there. Something, you know, decent so you get a level middle class lifestyle.
Hey, Marlene.
Yeah, I have a question.
A question, finally?
Well, I'm going to put it in the form of a question.
Thank you.
I think the McDonald's workers, and they call them unskilled, I think that job requires immense amount of patience, ability to deal with the public, ability to have food thrown in your face and complaints. It's like it's a customer service. I think it takes a lot of skill. Ability to get the order right, ability to get it. You know, I'm so tired of hearing the term unskilled and they shouldn't be paid well. And the question form is, don't you think so?
Yes, I do. I mean, that's a term. Now that you mention it, I really don't like that term either. Well, I tell you, UPS, we got jobs that are considered skilled and unskilled jobs. You know, certain jobs pay a dollar more. Like somebody who's unloading a package car is considered unskilled, but somebody loading it is called skilled. Because they're just taking the stuff out and putting it on the belt. And there's certain things they got to do. But the people who are putting it into the trucks got to put it in a certain area, you know, and if they're in a trailer, they got to scan it. So there's a little bit more to it, but each job has particular things they got to learn, you know, and all labor is valuable. But just like, you know, I don't like the term illegal, and I prefer undocumented, you know what I mean? Some terms are better than others. So if you got a suggestion for a better term, you know, I mean, I like to hear it because I really don't like that term unskilled either.
Okay, Charlie?
Yeah, Joe, what if I was negotiating for McDonald's? And I said, your employees are going to get $6 an hour. That's my last and final offer. Huh. What would you say?
Well, I mean, first of all, it's against the law, you know, but, I mean, I'm all for striking myself.
So you're going to strike McDonald's?
Well, they are.
Let's get serious. If you're negotiating for quite a few years, and your response to everything that management, you want this and this and this, you have a negotiating team, and everything, they say no.
Well, I was just saying,
you're going to get half. What is your response to them? I mean, you're voting against your negotiating team, and I have yet to hear that they're incompetent or stupid or lazy.
Well, I'm not saying that about local, but and like for example, the IBT, the International Brotherhood of Teamsters, they're very skilled in getting elected. You know, the international officers, they're great politicians, but as far as the international negotiating the contract, the way they look at it is if they can put out a contract and it passes, that's a victory to them. They don't have to work under the contract. You know, I mean, most bad contracts pass because they're sold by the international union and they're sold by the company and members, you know, are scared. But also the people that support the administration are gonna vote for those things. So that the people that are most active in the union are gonna vote for those things. But now, our local, I feel, you know, They can negotiate this, that, and other, and they do okay. But the true way to get a good contract is by mobilizing the membership to action and showing, like last time, we had a strike authorization vote, okay? And we had an over 90% strike authorization. So that's a tactic that you use, you know, that you have a strike authorization, the members vote for it, and it passes by strong margins. That makes them get off of it and, you know, give us a better contract. So there's a lot of things I've been involved in. And I was involved in a teacher strike. I saw these different tactics, all these things done to mobilize the membership to get a better contract. And when they don't do things to mobilize the membership, I see what they're doing wrong. I mean, and that's a lot of effort and work. And well, I'm not saying they're lazy, but compared to me, 99.9 people are lazy. I get 2 hours sleep here, 2 hours sleep there. I mean, I'm falling asleep at the wheel. I mean, be careful when you drive next to me. Be prepared to beep to keep me awake when I'm driving. Okay.
I got a question. A question. What kind of press do you have in your union? Do the Teamsters or the Democracy GDU? Do you have a press where the rank and file can raise their suggestions and their questions?
Okay,
repeat the question.
Yeah.
I kind of got it. Okay, now, for example, on the international level, you know, like, if you listen to progressive radio in Chicago, you'll hear different labor leaders on the radio shows. And sometimes, you know, you might hear Junior Hoffa, maybe on an Ed Schultz show or stuff like that. Sandy Pope actually got press on Fox News during the campaign. She was running against Junior Hoffa. So she actually got on there. A lot of times they like to try to put another opinion, whatever. But now TDU, Teamsters for Democratic Union, what we have is a paper. I get out 3,000 issues. I get out thousands of papers per issue 9 times a year. So we got a paper. We're the biggest, longest running rank and file movement in the United States. Okay. You know, nothing popping without us. I mean, because of us, you know, other rank and file movements sprung up, labor notes. You know, we're involved with labor notes. People are familiar with that. That's a reform movement. Labor notes. That's a reform movement of the general labor movement. Okay. We got a website. We got a website, tdu.org. We got a website for the UPS campaign in particular, the makeupsdeliver.org. So we're getting it out on internet and a paper. What I'd like to do, I'm gonna try to get this out there on the internet and everything like that. In Chicagoland area, there's a show called Labor Beat, you know, and different people are involved in different organizations who are involved in TDU. There's an article gonna be in there's an article in Fight Back about the struggle in the Vote No campaign in Tampa. Somebody else is doing an article, and a socialist worker, I think. I mean, so I would like, you know, I mean, I'm one guy, I'm doing everything I can. I've been running a Vote No campaign, but I'd like to get it out when, as our local contract's coming up, I'd like to get stuff out, you know, and I've been reaching out, maybe do something on Labor Beat myself, but haven't got around to, I'm doing everything I can. Okay. I need to get a couple hours sleep sometimes.
Excuses.
All right. We recently had a labor problem with the hockey union and the hockey owners, and now the Hawks are starting to get into the Stanley Cup. Can you comment on possibly what went right with that strike and with the labor negotiations in that union, or are you not familiar with it?
Sorry about that one. I didn't really keep up with that. I'm working a lot on this Teamsters UPS contract campaign. So I've been, and I don't have service. Mm-hmm. So I burned every bridge with every cable company and satellite company because they promised me all this stuff, and then they fell through on their promises. So then I stopped payment, and after several months, they eventually canceled, and I kept all their equipment. I told them they were going to get it back if they didn't follow through.
Mm-hmm. All right. I think that ends our question period, and we can move to the rebuttal period.
Let's thank our speaker. Let's thank our speaker.
All right. How many people have remarks to make? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Thanks.
You work
pretty good.
Well, at least 5 minutes. You're keeping time. Down.
I will make. Yes, I'll keep time. Let me see if my phone works. I'll keep time. Go ahead, Frank.
Okay. In general, this was a very good audience. They didn't start talking. And we should keep it that way. one full at a time. And that I was going to say that in general, this is not the case. Many people conduct secondary conversation, distracting everybody. Today it was different, it was very good. People were paying attention to the speaker. The one thing that I know for my observation coming from Latin America and living here, I have my own business for a while, and I know that when you are employed by a corporation, you are being fucked. It's simple as that, because the corporation is there out to extract money from society in spite of whatever the consequences for you or for everybody else are. The only thing that the corporation could manipulate is your salary, because the cost of renting the building or the materials are fixed. So, one fool at a time, please. So we have to realize that. And this fight will continue forever, because the corporations have gained so much power that now the world revolves about what they decide. They have bought countries, they have bought governments, they have bought everything. Now, this is not sustainable, because when the corporations go and exploit you or me or say, well, we get fucked, we die, that's it. But they are exploiting the environment in an unsustainable way. We are fucking up the sea, the air, the land, everything. Everything for the money now. Now this is a system that was established for, see what I mean down there? It's just very disturbing to me to see that people continue their own conversations. They don't give a shit about what the speaker is talking about. They have their own business down there. Anyway, you see that they are totally blind. We are totally inconsiderate that this is, the kids are being bullshit with the television, with these fucking games. It's a total dystopia. This is not working. And meantime, we are not going to look into the future, destroying the sea. By 2050, we will have a collapse of the sea, if not sooner. The latest thing that we are doing is that since we catch all the big fish in the sea, now we are picking up the zooplankton. We are making the nets small enough to pick these creatures that they are 1 centimeter long. And they are picking this by thousands of tons and use this for supplement for dog food and cat food. I mean, this is eating up our life support. When the oxygen in the atmosphere lowers to 18%, then there's no internal combustion engine that could work anymore, 18%. Now, we have 21% of oxygen in the air. But what is what replaces the oxygen that we consume by burning it in wood and in combustibles? It's the sea. The plankton in the sea is a major contributor to the oxygen that is renewing the atmosphere. We're killing it. We're killing them. 40% of the plankton in the southern seas have disappeared in the last 20 years. What the fuck are we doing? For money? For the corporation to fuck you? It's just incredible. And then the people here who somehow defend the corporation to the point that they committed suicide. They want the corporation to screw them. Why? Why is that? What is it entered into their heads? I don't understand it.
Okay, next.
I wish we all had the enthusiasm of our speaker, Joe. It was marvelous. I really enjoyed his enthusiasm and his perspective. It really helped. Which brings to mind the do we really think that any of our politicians are pro-labor or pro-worker? And they may claim to be so, but it really doesn't show out that way. For example, the 2010 sequester of funds, you may recall, to cut the agreement between the Republicans, Democrats, and Independents to cut spending so severely that it would be unconscionable to go ahead with it. And yet that's exactly what both the Republicans and the Democrats did. It was unconscionable. It was too radical to make any difference. But they went ahead with it. Now, they're planning another. There's in the House now, there's another sequester bill, which will move into the will be introduced in the Senate in August, to do the same thing, to cut spending. And we'll all hear the same sort of thing. It's not good. It's unconscionable to cut more spending and cut social services. But not one word, not one word of an alternative. Yes, we'll cut spending, but at the same time, we'll raise income taxes on those making more than $2 million a year, raise it back up to 80 or 90%. That would really make it unconscionable. But we won't hear that. We won't hear that. In 1917, when the Russian Revolution occurred, the Soviets, which are called councils, it's a term that we... consisted of the advanced workers in the Soviet in Russia. They began to have their council meetings, and they imposed on the leadership, Lenin and his group, their decisions. It worked until there were certain special interests that developed, and they then began to disregard the local councils or the local Soviets. In Toronto in 1923, there was a general strike. It was a marvelous example of worker unity. Not only the general workers, but the police, of all things, joined in the general strike. And the police asked the leaders of the general strike, what can we do? How can we assist? And the general strike committee said, go back to work. Protect the citizens, and they did. So we can learn a lot, and we need people like Joe to inspire us to go ahead and do the same thing.
My name is John Arthur, and I've been a labor activist for more than 40 years in Chicago. I'm not as young as Joe. I don't get around quite as much as he does. But I do a fair amount of work. I'm the librarian at Jobs of Justice in Chicago. I'm an activist with many different unions. But I'd like to make 4 points. The first one is the first attempt at industrial union. The original unions, the AFL, were only organized the craft workers, the skilled workers. In a factory, the skilled workers would have a union and the regular workers wouldn't. That was for all the way up until the 30s. The first attempt to have an industrial union was the syndicalist industrial workers of the world. And I want to remind Joe that the correct slogan was, an injury to one is an injury to all, which has been adopted by today's industrial unions. Then, in the 30s, after the in the terrible depression of the 30s, in the early 30s, there were three key strikes, which were led and won by a combination of some sort of socialist or radical, and the masses of the public, and the workers in the plant. First, there was the Toledo Auto Light Strike, which was led by the Mustyites. The Mustyites were the Christian socialists who later merged with the Trotskyists, which is my background. and Jim Busby was a wonderful labor leader. Then there was the San Francisco General Strike, which was led by the Communist Party, where the dock workers took the San Francisco Police Department, which was trying to break their strike, and they put them in the bay, literally. Workers took the San Francisco Police and threw them in San Francisco Bay, which is cold, and they won the general strike there. And the third and the penultimate strike was the Teamsters General Strike in Minneapolis, led by the Communist League of America, which was the Trotskyists. Farrell Dobbs, the great leader of the strike, wrote four books on the Teamsters. Teamster Rebellion is the first one, Teamster Politics, Teamster Power, and this will tell you how things went during World War II, Teamster Bureaucracy, when he was imprisoned for all his activities under the Smith Act, before the Communist Party was overattacked. Now, that's two things, injury to one is injury to all, the three big strikes in the 30s. Then, there were people inside the AFL who wanted to organize all the workers, okay? And those people were John L. Lewis and the miners, which was the only industrial union in the AFL. It was always an industrial union. It organized everybody from the guy who ran the chain, up and down elevator into there, to the smallest child who worked in mining coal. Everybody was a member of the union, always. Well, that union, the needle trades, which is now called the Workers United Chicago and Midwest Joint Board and the National Board. That union and the International Typographers Union, which was the craft union of typographers at newspapers, those three unions left the AFL and formed the Congress for Industrial Organization. And after they organized all the workers, it became the Congress of Industrial Organization, the CIO. That was the great militant union. Now, the local union that I was in for 22 years was called IBEW Local 1031. And it followed the CIO around and signed contracts with the boss that were not quite as good as the CIO contracts. That's how they got into business. But in 1955, this local had 52,000 members. I became a member in 1986. We made $20 an hour. We had air conditioning. That was a union. So we had everything. Dental, mental, whatever you had. And I tell you, I used those mental benefits. But in 1955, they had 52,000 members. Today, they have 418. From 52,000 in 1955 to 418 in 2013. That shows you what they've done to the labor movement in this country. It's down to the last, and it's fight or die.
Well, thanks a lot, Joe, for an inspiring talk. It's not fashionable in the United States now to be grateful, but I'll tell you what, I am grateful. I was part of a union. I worked for years and years for the state. Since June 1st, 1964, every damn month I got a check. There are probably a few, it's an older crowd, I know, but there are probably a couple people in this room who weren't even born in June of 64. I've gotten checks all that time. Health care, dental care, and I live in affordable housing. I think everybody ought to have what I got. There's no feeling that I have that I am any better than anyone else. So I'm wondering why we got people unemployed, why we got people on the street. It's terrible. But now I want to go to community organizing. A lot of the stuff that Joe said reminded me that community organizing and labor organizing are very close. He talked about the community and how important it was to connect with the community. He talked about connecting with your customers or clients. Jane Addams Senior Caucus gets money from SEIU. We get 5,000 bucks every year from SEIU. So boy, they connect with us, and we fight for make sure that they get good labor contracts, good pay, and good working conditions. He talked about everybody being able to do full time and some things that a lot of labor unions don't talk about. He said he wants that for everybody, for all. So that's something that some labor groups don't say. They say, hey, where's mine? I want to make sure our people get what we want, no matter what. Well, that's not good to me. One of the things he didn't mention, he didn't use the word, but boy, he illustrated it, and that's being credentialed. At Jane Addams Senior Caucus, we often do that. We say, I'm in Jane Addams Senior Caucus, I'm in the Finance Committee, we wear a t-shirt, we wear a cap, I got my cap over there, we wear a button to let everybody know we are legitimate. We are Jane Addams Senior Caucus. The importance of winning and community organizing, winning, you got to cut an issue, you got a big problem, you cut part of it out, something that's big enough to fight for, but you've got a good chance to win. And you make sure to win, because when you win, you get support from everyone. So I think that covers all my points. Thanks a lot, Joe.
I'm Michael Foley. I want to say that I agree with what Joe says. I've heard Joe speak several times. I always like to hear him speak. He's an intelligent guy. He's got good things to say. And I think well of Joe as a human being. I think Joe is trying to do something decent and worthwhile for the people of this country. And I think Joe is trying to do something decent and worthwhile for working people in this country. Yes. Another thing Joe mentioned tonight was there should be a worldwide minimum wage. Well, I've talked about something like that before. There should be some acknowledgement that one of the reasons there's so much turmoil in this world is because the lords of the empire are just jerking us all around. There's probably 3 or 4 billion people in this world. Their life would be significantly financially improved if they got a job making $2 a day. And the people that run this world are just playing us all off one against the other. Some guy gets a job working in a factory in this country, works there 20, 30 years. He's doing a good job, he's making a good product. And then they say, well, that's it for you, buddy. We're hiring people on the other side of the world, we're paying them $5 a day. No more than $30 an hour, P.S. There could be a law passed in this country. Could be said that nothing can be imported into this country. Merchandise cannot be imported into this country to be sold in this country unless the people making that stuff overseas, wherever they are, they're making $10 an hour. Yeah. Yeah. There's no reason why there could be some guy setting up a factory in Mexico, making something in Mexico, paying people 50 cents an hour in Mexico. And if they set up a factory in Texas, they got to pay $10, $12 an hour. It's just ridiculous. Mm-hmm. You can do something about that by saying that merchandise is going to be coming into this country for sale. It's got to be made by people making a decent wage. There's another thing that happens in this country. Joe didn't mention it. But it's a widely accepted business practice in this country. You got billion-dollar corporation in this country that offer internships. People come to the country and say, I'd like to apply for a job. And they say, okay, buddy, we'll give you a job for 6 months. You got to work for free.
I'd like to stand here and say I don't understand how that can be. There's something called minimum wage and all that. There's labor laws in this country. But I do understand how that can be. Billion-dollar corporations pay a lot of money to politicians in the form of campaign contributions to pass laws to say that's acceptable. It's just that simple. Politicians take bribe money, and they suck up to the people that give them the bribe money. Oh, there's another thing. A lot of people that rip unions actually do belong to unions. There's unions in this country, and then there's unions. Some unions are called labor unions or trade unions. Some unions are called professional organizations. Pardon me. Doctors got the AMA, lawyers got the ABA, even these manufacturing companies, they all got stuff like the American Association of Tire Manufacturers, the American Association of this manufacturer, the American Association of Oil Refiners, the American Association of this, that, and the next thing. They're just unions. They're supposedly unions made up of bosses and supervisors and owners. But all it is a union of people who get together to try to improve their economic standing one way or another. There's nothing illegal about it, but when people start ripping about, oh, the unions, the crummy unions, this and that, a lot of people that talk like that belong to some kind of union that's looking out for their financial interests. And another thing about unions, people rip unions, every union contract is signed by representatives of the people who own a company. Joe works for UPS, it's a stockholder company. I don't know the names of the people that own it. But the people who signed that union contract are representatives of the workers and representatives of the people who own that company. Everything in that union contract, no matter how much the owners bitch about it, they signed that contract, they agreed to it, that's what they wanted. Okay, Kim. So the other thing, last thing I've said this before, it's about capitalism. We do not live in a capitalist country. We live in a welfare country. As long as the government has taken our money, $185 billion of it, and given it to the people who own General Motors, this is not a capital club. If this was a capitalist country, there would be no more General Motors. There would be no more AIG Insurance Company who was on welfare. Chrysler has been on welfare twice. And the 10 biggest banks in this country are welfare banks. And they're being bankrolled because the politicians that take the campaign contributions from these people take our money and give them their welfare checks. Billions and billions of dollars in welfare. This is not a capitalist country. This country is run by bribery and armed robbery. The bosses, the owners, whoever you want to call it, the empire, the lords of the empire, the slaves of the empire, they bribe politicians. Politicians send their gunslingers to get money from us. They're called tax collectors. They send their gunslingers to get money from us. The gunslingers take the money back to the politicians. And the gunslingers, the politicians, and the lords of the empire split up our money. That's a welfare system. That's not capitalism. That's all.
Next.
I've never heard such a crock of crap in my life. I want to tell you that our speaker tonight told us that in order to get what you want, it's okay to break the law once in a while. That sounds very much like by any means necessary. And I want to tell you that capital has the means. Don't forget that. And if labor is going to break the law and do vandalism and sabotage and things like that and things to shut down production, and they're going to ignore the law, then that will lead to capital ignoring the law. And it'll come down to a thing like in 1917 or something, when strikers got shot. And that's what that'll lead to. So let both sides firmly abide by the law. Let's not get off on some kind of a dream machine tangent where you think you can violate the law and step all over management and get away with it. That will only happen to a certain point. Then the shooting will start. Thank you.
Assassin.
All right. Next.
As much as it galls me to admit this, I don't totally disagree with Dave Trask. We do have to have the unions abide by the laws because of staunch Teamster. Yes, we do. Because if you don't, you have something much worse than what Dave was talking about. That brings in what happened in 1933 in Nazi Germany and in 1922 in fascist Italy. And do we really want fascism back again?
They passed laws.
I don't think so. With regard to some of the other comments that were made, first I'd like to thank Joe for his presentation. Well, I did not agree with every last thing that Joe said. I agree with most of it, and we need people like Joe out there fighting for union rights and for worker solidarity. My mother was a staunch member of the Chicago Teachers Union. And as for me, I'm still a card-carrying, albeit retired, member of the Teamsters. And the fact that they helped me with my nasty invasive supervisor a few years ago was why I was able to retire from Cook County after 30 years of service with a full pension. Now, with regard to another comment that was made about how that Mike Foley made about how we should, how everyone in the world should get $2 a day at least. That's not new. In 1840, during the presidential campaign of that year, the Whigs said that Martin Van Buren was in favor of giving, the incumbent president, Martin Van Buren, was in favor of giving everyone 50 cents a day in French soup. And the Whig Party and General Harrison, who were the eventual winners, were in favor of giving everyone $2 a day in roast beef. With regard to the speaker who said that she would like to this country to go back to the 1950s, are you really, you have, there's an old saying that goes, be careful what you wish for, you may get it. Do we really want to go all the way back to the 50s? Do we really want to see a return to McCarthyism? Do we really want to see a return to the racism of that period as directed against blacks, Native Americans? The anti-Semitism that's still went around in that period when my own parents went to a place in New England, tried to check in, and were told they couldn't stay there because they were Jewish. That kind of thing got outlawed in 1964 by the Civil Rights Act. So, while there are many things that I liked about the 50s, although granted I was a little kid at the time, and there were many things that I know that my parents liked about the 50s, I don't know that we entirely want to go back to that. Certainly I don't. With regard to the list of important strikes that was made by Trotsky, he left out one. He left out the 1937 sit-down strike against General Motors. That strike, which helped the United Auto Workers get off the ground in earnest, also brought about the passage by Congress and the signature by President Roosevelt of the National Labor Relations Act. Thank you.
I did not mean that I like that rhythm about the 1950s. Let me make this pretty clear. You had rapid, discrimination against blacks, against Native Americans, against Jews. So there was a lot wrong during that period as well. Well, what I was referring to, the economic health of the average worker, is what I was referring to. I wish labor activists would consider perhaps another paradigm, and that would be to try to use, the tools that are available with capitalism to support businesses that respect worker rights and human rights and do not rape the environment, and we stop, you know, patronizing those companies that don't. Another thing I would like to see us investigate is perhaps divesting any kind of investments, labor unions, you know, public entities, and take a good hard look at where those tax dollars are going. Are they going toward, you know, companies that are really against our self-interest, and begin a public education campaign along these lines? So these are things that I hope labor activists would consider and see if we can not only organize politically, which I totally agree with what Joe said, but also economically, and see if we can't even progress, you know, further on that. I would also like to make some comments about, you know, the Equal Pay Act, which is the 50th anniversary. I've been a union member for over 30 years. And like one of the speakers, you know, indicated prior, you know, to me, yes, I think everyone should have the kind of pensions and benefits that I enjoy at this time. And to the degree that these things are threatened, I think a way to organize, you know, against these moves, I find it highly alarming, this free trade agreement that appears to be on fast track, you know, authority. I think nothing good would come of it. And from what I recently read, they want to just eliminate any kind of domestic, you know, regulations that are geared toward protecting us in the workplace, the environment, and things that kind of make life worthwhile. And that's what I find so alarming about this free trade agreement. A word about women, you know, in the labor force.
Yeah.
What I found out, and I'm going to finish on this comment, was I had read a long time ago, was that one of the founding members of NOW was actually a labor organizer. A fact that she kept secret because it was at the height of the McCarthy era, and, you know, and the labor organizers were not necessarily treated, you know, in a friendly manner by, you know, during the McCarthy era. Her name was Betty Friedan, and she died several years ago. So that is all I have to say.
Thank you. Very often, people are advocating things here. Some people think they're utopian. But I've got something to tell you all. You, tonight, have been my utopia. And here's why. Because you miss things. When you miss things, that's when you appreciate them. I've been wondering around where I live, which is unfortunately has too many poor people, looking for a few bucks so I can afford car fare to go to the Veterans Hospital and a few other things. When I came to the college, even before I asked someone for some money, I felt at home. Of course, I started here in 1957, so that figures. So I just wanted to let you know that something good is happening here, whatever you were able to put into effect in the larger country. And now I want to quote a digger who was one of the part of the left wing of the Puritan Revolution. When Adam delved and Eve spanned, who was then the gentle man? they're talking, what they were talking about was this redistribution of the land. Redistribution sounds like it's utopian. And then we hear, oh, don't break the law, don't ever break the law. Right now in Chicago, the RICO statute is being applied to the gangs. If it were applied to the financial institutions which rob Main Street and funneled $18 trillion into Wall Street, they, not only would they all be in jail, we, the people, would own the financial system. Now, yes, that's utopian, even though it would be in accord with the law. Because when they prosecute, whether it's a gang or a corporation, and then they apply the RICO statute, what it says is, in a way, it's a very unfair law. It says, even before trial begins, we can confiscate all property that came from your illegal activities. Well, I think the illegal activities on Wall Street created trillions of dollars of wealth on Wall Street. And if we applied the same law that we are urged to always obey the law, if we applied that law to the billionaires, a lot of our problems would be over. Thank you.
I'm gonna talk tonight, and I do apply like what Brother Joe is doing with the unfair worker practices. I like unions and when they come out and fight injustice, but I'm also thinking tonight how much we benefit from our capitalist system. How much we have when we have these corporations around. And how much good came out of the revenue bond from Wall Street. It was, for me, the single greatest invention of the 18th century was called the stock common revenue bond and the corporation. Why? Because it provided a means to get a bunch of pot of money together, get a bunch of people cooperating to get a big project done. It was also a way to, after some reforms were enacted, to get people generally out of poverty. Now you must remember that even though we undertook the industrialization of the late 18th, early 19th centuries, it took a while for the average worker to get his fair share. In the early teens and 20s of the last century, there was a lot of unfair labor peace between the bosses and the unions. It was only finally in the 20s when the two of them started cooperating together that labor peace was established, that we finally started seeing a booming middle class. And even after World War II, we saw a lot of that same cooperation between the two sides. Now for me, the one thing that I do see that gives me hope for modern capitalism is the spirit of innovation and how much things have changed. Many of you guys remind me of these guys kind of stuck in the late 60s, and there have been a few things that have happened since then. One of them happens to be called the internet. One of them happens to be called the smartphone. One of them happens to be called a lot of change has come around that really happens. How many of you guys have heard of a company called Google? And how many of you guys know what they, how fairly paid and well taking care of their workers are? How many of you guys have heard of a lot of internet startups that have failed and gone down the tubes through bankruptcy? And how many of you realized have succeeded? When you truly have an innovative economy and allow a company to grow and to fail, that produces growth. And it's only been through the fundamental growth of companies, the fundamental aspects of competition that produce the goods that we need. It is only through the spirit of innovation and competition that we can really see things work in this country well. I often like to say, quote that was done by the inventor of RCA, and I'm trying to remember his name, Sarnoff, if I remember.
David Sarnoff.
David Sarnoff. Competition sometimes produces the worst in people, but it gives you the best in products.
Oh.
And sometimes a lot of problems occur when you do get concentration of power at the top. Thank God we have the unions to countervail it. But does that mean I'm going to scrap the system? No. It just means we have to keep fighting and reforming the system. Wall Street needs to be reformed by introducing not less competition, but more. Get rid of the monopolistic power of these 10 big banks and allow some real competition to come in. Because we don't live under a capitalist system. We live under what we call mercantilism, which is exactly what Adam Smith decried in his book, The Wealth of Nations, which many capitalists like myself will like to quote.
The internet came out of the not-for-profit sector.
I know it did. It came out of the ARPANET. It came out of the Department of Defense through government research. And it was DARPANET.
And Tim Berners-Lee at
CERN. And I understand all that history, too.
And open source software.
That's correct. That's correct. What I'm simply saying is that, you know, there is a certain, but it really didn't take off commercially until the private sector had it in there. But there was a set of common standards that were developed first. One of the things that electronics companies do is there's a lot more cooperation than you might realize in the set of standards that are produced around the world, in the set of common ways that people cooperate together. For example, even your post offices and the way they deliver packages around the world is part of the International Telecommunications and Postal Workers Treaties from the early whatever. And the barcodes, you know, but a lot of that has been established. And it's only because it's in the best interest of those companies to cooperate in a lot of those cases that do it. And you also have to remember, we are customers of a lot of these companies. Our money goes, we in effect vote to where our stuff is. I'm out of time. I'm violating my own rules of time right now. I'm going 6 minutes, so. Yeah, sit down and shut up, right?
Younger squirt. I knew Abraham J. Musty, referred to as the leader of the Mustyites and the Autolite workers strike, sit down strike. What? Was it a sit down strike?
Yes.
It was before my time anyway. A.J. Musty was, when I knew him, he was the retired leader of the Fellowship of Reconciliation, emeritus leader, and the instigator of the Liberation Magazine, was a leading pacifist, sort of an anarcho-revolutionary publication. It wasn't particularly Christian, but it certainly backed the civil rights movement, and it backed the peace movement in this country. And internationally, A.J. had long fingers, long thin fingers, and he would conduct the editorial board meetings, which were somewhat acrimonious at times, and he would listen carefully to each speaker, and he would try to summarize what they had said so that they knew that they were being heard. And he got this as habit as the Presbyterian minister, because the Presbyterian minister doesn't have a vote on the session of a church, but does sort of conduct the church, the meetings of the elders of the church. He was pastor of the Labor Temple in Manhattan for many years. One of my high school teachers was a member of that congregation. It would help, I think, our speaker and others to have something more of an economics background and something more of a social organization background. Maybe you can begin with union talks. His talks tonight were very much wrapped up in the current affairs of the Teamsters Union. Many of his references may have been a little obscure to those who were not current with Teamster affairs, but they were educational. Labor Notes, the publication John Erickson has been circulating. You neglected it. I used to subscribe to it. It's a very good publication. I hope that some of you may be able to pick up a sub to it and read it. End of my remarks.
Okay.
Three short points. All I meant by bringing up the three localized general strikes is that that caused the split in the AFL and caused the national CIO that could do things like sit-down strike and nationwide strikes. So the CIO was a huge advance based on those three strikes. Second thing, I'd like to point out that Dobbs, the leader of the Minneapolis General Strike, went on to be the national organizer for the Teamsters. His assistant was a fellow named Jimmy Hoffa Sr. And he went on with little Jimmy to organize the whole trucking industry at that time into the union and became an industrial union. And the third thing, for my little friend over here, is yes, Marx did say the union is the seed of socialism.
Okay, next.
I'll appreciate if you'll indulge me for an extra 60 seconds. I'm glad that David Sarnoff was mentioned. When he testified before the Senate Communications Committee, or whatever it was, in 1934, before they passed the FCC law, he was testifying in favor of the law. And in his testimony, he said, we will not sell advertising on television. Television will be educational and artistic and informational. And we are going to make our money. He may even have believed it at the time, I don't know. He said, we're going to make our money from selling the televisions and ultimately selling the radios and ultimately the television. So I'm really glad that the gentleman brought up David Sarnoff as the ideal capitalist. He was right in implying that. Thank you.
Let me put it this way, Mo. Walt Disney's wonderful.
All right, you guys are kind. All right, I'll say a speaker again. Thanks, Joe, for your speech and your posters and your We've never had a speaker with such costume effects in a while. Although we've had some in the past, I'm being eclectic as usual. 1950s, by the way, the most significant clauses and concessions from the employers were from the 50s. People don't realize that. They think it's 30s or something like that. No, it was the 50s. The guy over here, Jack Metzger, wrote a book, as a matter of fact, on that. He did all the research. And it was in the 50s that the unions really got some good contract clauses in there. Okay, let's see, what else? Where should I begin here? The Teamsters. Oh, little story, I had to practice grievance arbitration. And there were independents, and then there were eight Teamsters. And we divided ourselves into two teams. These Teamsters really worked at it, spent all week in preparation, had their legal department, and on relatively short notice, I became the chief negotiator on the other side, and I won the case. And to add insult to injury, the teacher made everyone sit through my summation twice. It was videotaped. But the Teamsters, let's see. Regarding contracts, some things, actually, you got to look out for. What is a contract? It's basically three rights come into conflict here. You have management rights, you have union rights, and you have the employee rights. And those three come together. And you got to come out and somehow get something coherent after all those three entities are looked at. The most important thing in any contract, though, by far and away, is your grievance arbitration. Because without it, that means you can be fired and all kinds of things can be done to an employee. That's like hiring at will. And if you have a grievance arbitration, you cannot be removed from your position without establishing just cause. That's by far and away the most crucial contract, part of the contract you want to look at. And every single contract, that's the first thing. I read these things, I write them too. So the other things you want to, and you hit on this a little bit, you want to try to avoid two-tier systems, the new hires, things like that. That's one way of really putting in some unfair and unjust kind of conditions. And you hit on it, you were talking there by the unborn and the retirees. That's kind of a two-tier approach. You really don't want that. Let's see, I've been doing a lot of, on Friday I concluded. I determined contracts, and actually I have one contract that I think has been about 14 years in effect, but they thought it was okay, so they haven't renegotiated it. I did one just on Friday. I skunked the employer, I must admit. You have to write compromise language, and I presented the compromise, and they thought it was so wonderful, they agreed to it all, and they didn't realize it, but they will maybe a week or two from now. That's way too late. there's things like term contracts, and there's also a whole other world. There's ongoing negotiations about changes in the conditions of employment. And I enjoy those too. Some of the more interesting ones I did, I negotiated work at home arrangements where employees can work at home. We call it hoteling. And there's entire offices where people, if they do come to work, they have like shared, they don't have permanent office spaces or desks or cubicles and things like that. It was kind of an interesting negotiation. Only employees who work 3 days a week in the office get a desk. So it's a whole new different thing. Now the other thing, there are all kinds of things that came under that. Even what if there's an on-the-job injury, you're in your house and things like this, you know. Some of those things did come up. Actually, my primary concern in that is that people would be working overtime and not getting paid for it. It's been found that people that work at home work longer hours.
than you think. But it is an accommodating situation. The other one that I did that was kind of interesting, he mentioned it, the social media. A lot of people have terminals that their employer furnishes. Like you, Tim, you work in an office, your employer gave you a terminal. Yep. But if you sit down and wrote on that terminal on social media, my boss is a no good dog, can they fire you? Huh. And people send emails all day and things like that. Is that free speech? You know, is it protected speech and things like this? It's kind of interesting one. That one still hasn't been settled yet. You got to be cool about that. And emails have been the great snitch system. People get excited and write back. They get snitch on each other. They use things like that. It's in writing, a record there. You can never take it away. So that was kind of interesting, the negotiations. That's still one that's ongoing. Evolving technology. Anyhow, there's a midterm here. Now, I have to disagree. Like here, one thing Joe said, one thing here, and not to bore you with technicalities, he was advocating expedited arbitration. That means you can go to arbitration real quickly. I don't know if I'd go along with that. There's two sides to society. I think you ought to have slow down the process. I'll tell you, if I was a company, I could fire 10 people. Arbitrations can run, we just paid for one, $12,000. An arbitrator, now you could cost the union about $100,000. Who pays for your arbitrations? You got to think about this when you're negotiating contracts. That's what I mean. All right, you give me a sign here. No, I would slow down the process, and it will all depend on who pays for this. That's why you put together a negotiating team, and very often their votes. It could go either way. There's pros and cons. Expedited arbitration, if the employer makes a change, and you want to stop the change from implementing it, there you might want it quick. If it's just getting people, the fire department was broken by going to arbitration, the union. They got 300 arbitrations. And each of those could run $5,000 to $10,000 and require significant hours of legal work. So I don't know if I, you know, there's something you gotta stop and think about this when you vote on this. Let's see. I talked about that. One of the things, I've mentioned this before, I keep a little video on my desk. It's a movie called Teamster Boss. And that's what I aspire to be. Now, Joe likes this community-based organizing, where you go off and get the rank and file. I'm really not too good at that. But I admire the Teamster Bosses, because they are quite effective. They really are, let's face it. They did pretty good for their Democratic, hell no. But they manage to get things for their people. So that's what I mean. This depends on, you know, which side you're looking at, these kinds of things like that. Regarding laws of the United States, this is amazing. He gave examples here where they couldn't even go out and say, look, Walmart. The law took the side of Walmart against him and his pals that said it's no good. You can imagine what the laws are against the people who work at Walmart. It's kind of a sad state of affairs when passing out stickers is a big fucking issue. But there's where your labor laws are, that you're arguing these issues like that. Now, the labor laws in the United States are conceivably the very worst in the world. And there's very many, many people who say that. The workers here have no labor laws whatsoever. They don't, and there's no one to enforce it, especially if a Republican is president of the United States. There is no labor laws that are enforced. You may not think this doesn't happen. It just happened for an 8-year period of time. They just won't go anywhere. So in terms of obeying the law, I'm trying to give you another example of the law. As a matter of fact, I give a little lecture where labor unions in the United States are in fact against the law. And it can be shown. So I have a very distasteful feeling for the laws when these are not laws written by the people. They're not written by the working people of the United States. They're written by the capitalist, fascist, Wall Street money mongers. So, in terms of those stupid laws,
I mean, you can't boycott something. You have a secondary boycott. You get you can't wear stickers. Come on. And you're telling me I'm going to what laws do we have? None whatsoever.
And you've just disrespected a lot of the laws and our things by going 10 minutes.
We do. We're
Teamster boss and shutting you up.
No. That's when you go last, you get an allowance. Right.
You know, Joe, let's get up here.
This guy's talking about expedited arbitration.
Expedited arbitration.
Yeah, he's going to bankrupt the union.
Yeah, some people have talked a little bit about the history of the United States and the labor movement. And it's like the struggles, you know, that started to change in the labor movement, you know, began. You know, the modern labor movement, like in the 30s, that they had all those militant general strikes, these sit-down strikes. And, I mean, there was a time in this country, you know, from then, maybe even, you know, starting to say in the early 40s, late 40s, whatever, to the early 70s, where this country was headed in the right direction. There was all kind of problems, but people were actually struggling to change those problems. People were struggling to end racism and discrimination and everything like that. People were fighting for unions and better contracts and for rights. You know, fighting for women's rights and all kinds of rights. The country was headed in the right direction, even with all the issues that were going on. But then, you know, there's a few things that happened in the early 70s. You know, you might think about getting off the gold standard, losing union density, the tax on unions, the different laws that were changing. I mean, there's kind of a lot of contradictions, even in those early days. But, you know, since from the early 70s, from early 40s to late 40s, early 70s, wages kept up with productivity. As the workers became more productive, they got paid more, okay? So they can afford the goods and services that they were actually producing. So what really happened in the 70s, the raises did not keep up with productivity, not to mention inflation. So it got more and more that people couldn't buy the goods and services that they were producing. So what did people do to continue this lifestyle? Well, the first thing they did is usually, you know, for a lot of time, you know, in the white community, you know, it was just the male working, and then now the female had to work. You had to have two people working to keep up with the same lifestyle. Well, another thing that they did, when that wasn't enough to keep up with this, you know, trying to attain a middle-class lifestyle, then people had to max out their credit cards. Okay, when they did that, and when they maxed that out, what did they have to do? They had to get equity in their home, so then they use all equity in their home to contain this lifestyle. People should be, if they work, you know, an 8-hour day, they work 30 years, they should be able to have a comfortable lifestyle. If you work for a living, you should be able to have a roof over your head, food on your table, a car in your garage, be able to send your kids to college, have a vacation, have health insurance. I mean, that's the so-called American dream, you know? So that's, I don't think that's asking for too much if you work for a living. So, I mean, that's what happened from the 40s to 70s. But even though there was contradictions, like for example, all these struggles actually got them to, you know, create this National Labor Relations Act and grievance procedures. And I'm all for laws that are in our favor, but the thing is, you know, these laws were designed to stop, you know, to create labor peace, to stop militant struggles. I got this grievance procedure. I had somebody pay for supervisors working. You supervisors ain't supposed to do our work. So, you know, they wrote it down and got witnesses and all that. And then, you know, time goes on, and they don't want to do it anymore. Why? Because it took several months. Then they finally got paid, and then they understood they got paid. But it's this grievance procedure, and all these laws is designed to stop militant struggle. Back in the day when they fired somebody, you know, everybody stopped working, the person went back to the job. Now we got these lengthy grievance procedures. So this, and that reminds me of this expedited arbitration. You know, it works for us. What we got in our last contract is for discipline. You know, if people get disciplined, it goes through the grievance procedure, so that's fine. But so even while they're on notice of termination, they're working. But there's certain things called cardinal sins that they're off work. They'd be kept off work for a few years. And that could, you know, break somebody financially, they could lose their home, wife, you know, all kinds of things could go wrong. So what we've got is called a sitting arbitrator. When we're hearing discipline cases where people are out of service, the arbitrator is sitting at the panel. We have a panel, you know, it's even with company and union, and guess what usually happens? It's usually deadlocked. So we have a sitting arbitrator to decide those cases, and the person knows after a month or two at the most whether they have a job or not be in limbo for a couple of years. And we've been having it now going on 5 years, and it works for us. And another local just got that in their supplement, you know, and so they're recommending a vote yes. You know, so, you know, thing is, talk about, you know, this, that, or another, and, you know, they criticize people like the red bait, you know, and, you know, kind of social assistant, and everybody's got their own agenda and own program and everything like that. But if you're fighting for workers' rights, if all these different people spoke out that led these different strikes and these things going on, I don't care what they call themselves. If you're fighting for workers' rights, you're on my side. I don't care what they call you. And now, what we got is called, what are you talking about, a little bit about labor history. Farrell Dobbs and Hoffa Sr. Yeah, Hoffa Sr. learned how to organize from Trotsky's. I'm not a Trotskyist, not a member of the organization, but a Trotskyist, Farrell Dobbs, led that strike, the Teamster Rebellion. And they led the general strike, okay? They fought in the they had a strike, and then the company sent thugs after them. They fought the thugs in the street. The company violated the law and tried to beat them up with thugs. They fought back and won. So then they got the police. You know, the police came in there and tried to stop the strike. Well, they ended up getting beat up too. So then they didn't want no more. So then they had some bigger, uglier thugs, basically, you know, and beat them back. They went on to win the strike. And then guess what? When you fight back and win, everybody likes to win, right? How many Miami Heat fans are out there? You always hear about all that because they're the you know doing well. And everybody's a Blackhawks fan. There's like a million people when they won. When we're having a protest against the oil companies, there's, you know, we had a little protest there because why, a million hockey fans are coming up because Blackhawks won. Everybody likes a winner. So when you fight back and win, that's how, you know, we're organizing people. We just want to organize. We organized 30 people in this direct trucking. We had to organize in victory. But, you know, that's like putting Band-Aids on, you know, if your throat's cut. What we need to do is win contracts, good contracts. We need a good, enforce the contract. Then people will be, when we fight back and win, people want to be Teamsters. And that, we can organize people a lot better that way if we can fight back and win and show a way to move forward.
And thank you all for coming. Good night, and I hope that we'll have many more.